says, Jesus is Lord.
Oh, no. Jesus is Lordists. Gotta love them. So, Dar, I have started the recording.
Okay, you have?
I have started the recording. This is the Friday Night Roundtable, as one-sided as it is, because we have no theists.
Okay. So, I'm going to start recording myself. Welcome to the Friday Night Roundtable, September 30th, 2011. First topic, which will be our main topic right now, is going to be abortion. People's stances on abortion. I guess we will start with, we'll go in order as I see it on the screen, so each in a doubt.
My stance on abortion?
Yes.
I believe that the right to choose is primary to the argument of whether or not to, you know, to go through with having an abortion. But personally, I'm lucky. I don't have a womb. I don't have to make this decision. But I would never even drive someone to an abortion clinic. I am personally pro-life. I would just never vote to take anyone's right to choose themselves away.
Headless.
I'm kind of with Michael on that. I would not take someone's right to do this away because I can see too many reasons that it may be needed or could be required. I just wouldn't want to see someone just using it as their sole purpose for birth control or for gender selection of a child.
Al1981X?
Okay, embarrassingly, I'm more or less with the first two people there. I couldn't really contribute anything without going off on some kind of massive essay, so I'll say the first two people have more or less spoken for me. Sorry.
Complete?
I'm pro-life, but at the end of the day, I'm really just pro-choice because I wouldn't want to force my opinions on anyone else. So I believe the decision really comes down to the mother.
Okay. Violently graceful.
Pro-choice.
Anything else you want to add, or just pro-choice?
No, I think that's an adequate descriptor.
Okay. Arsenic cigarettes, which is now known as nicotine in silence.
Okay. Having had the opportunity to decide, I chose to have a kid, so I'm pro-choice because I really don't think it's anyone's fucking business but your own. This is going to be such an interesting debate.
It is. Evo Chen.
Life begins at arousal. You're all going to hell.
No, seriously. I've never been in a situation where abortion was actually considered an option, so I can't really add that much to the discussion, but like everybody else in the call, I'm pro-choice.
Okay. Just to put myself out there also, I am pro-choice because there are I find that some people that are against abortion do not look at all of the minute details about abortion, about what happens during the pregnancy itself. They just go, no abortion, period, and not think about birth defects, complications, life endangerment, and all of that.
I would agree with that entirely. I would also throw in that normally when you're aborting a fetus, like within the first or second trimester, all you're really aborting is a bundle of cells within the first trimester and second trimester, a bundle of cells and potential body parts. In essence, you'd only be really getting rid of a, say, a seed, that had been fertilized, or a seed that had started to germinate, if you will.
Okay.
If that makes sense, assuming I use the right term.
Did anybody here watch Ray Comfort's 180?
Yes.
Again, only the first 3 minutes.
Okay. Brian J., before that comment, will you come onto Skype so that I can add you to the call?
But Mordishi's back, and he says he's had the abortion as well.
Yeah, assuming Mordecai is not actually trolling, that would be interesting to have him on the call.
Yes, Mordecai, are you trolling, or do you honestly think that women should not have abortions?
Also, Mordecai, do you have a best friend named Rigby? Oh, come on, nobody watches the regular show?
What are you talking about?
Eleanor Rigby was a fabulous track.
Oh, okay.
His last name, Richler.
I would like to point out that you're, how old?
27.
27, and you're watching a show that my 10-year-old nephew records. Just saying.
It's a good show.
Okay, Mordecai, would you like in on the call?
Hey, nothing against Mordecai, but the Bible is not science.
I have a question kind of related to abortion for complete rationality.
Okay.
Had you heard about Amendment 26? Because I know you live in that state.
Yeah, in Mississippi?
Mm-hmm.
They're trying to outlaw abortion.
Yeah, and some kinds of birth control.
Right, yeah. I actually didn't know about it. I just heard about it on the internet.
I actually called my mom because she was shocked when I actually started talking about political shit, and she hadn't even heard of the initiative.
Wow.
Well, this is kind of the way they do things. They put things like this through with no fuss, no alarms, just to get them through, and then they say, right, okay, well, once we've got it through, then people can discuss it, because it's too late.
Hello. From Zelda, from Arsenic, Nicotine and Silence's video, she talked about how they were going to redefine personhood.
Dar, you forgot Pale Pegging Princess.
Shoot, Mike.
We'll get to that later on. We'll do that in the after call. In the after show call.
Who's this guy has just made a very, very good point on the whole abortion thing. It's not alive until brain function, which is a very, very valid point. Because until you've actually got a functioning nervous system and ways to process things like pain and consciousness and stuff like that, you are really just a bundle of cells. It's like any other invasive organism that happens to be within another organism.
Well, you've moved the bar for the standard of life there, because broccoli is alive.
Well, see, there's a distinction to be made.
Yeah,
when we talk about plant life, yeah, that's a long time, but obviously we're talking about human life.
So why is it that you've selected brain function as that point? It seems just as arbitrary as conception.
Recognizably alive, how about that?
Yeah, the point that
you can see biological functioning happening in the cells of a zygote.
To answer your point, Michael?
Uh-huh.
The reason why brain function is a good yardstick for human life is because that is what we are actually discussing. I don't think anybody would have any problem whatsoever in eating a carrot before it's fully formed, or a cabbage before it's fully formed, or even a stalk of broccoli before it's fully formed. In fact, if you look in the supermarket, you find the younger the vegetable, the more tasty and the more likely it is to be, air quotes, choice.
Yes, but we do have vegans who would never eat an egg.
true, and there's also vegetarians that wouldn't kill a chicken. Your point?
My point is, it's a life form that's closer to us, and there are people who make the moral stance that it's wrong to eat eggs.
Yeah, but yeah, that's
and
arbitrary.
There are people that take the moral stance that owning slaves is beneficial to both themselves and the slave. Your point?
Michael, a chicken egg is not fertilized.
Oh, yeah? Why do I always get these little chicken bits in my eggs?
Because are you buying your chicken from a farm?
Yes.
Are you buying your egg from a farmer?
Yes, I am.
There you go.
Why? Go to a supermarket, you will never find an egg that's been fertilized.
But then they don't taste as good.
Then what is your argument about, Mike?
My argument is that there are people who make a moral stance against eating something before it has brain function.
Hey, Barney,
Did you just make the argument that an unborn chicken is more tasty than an unfertilized egg?
I think he did.
Yes.
Hey, guys, my cousin is going to come in. So do you think we can allow guests to chat for a bit? Because he doesn't have Skype.
Oh, hey, cousin.
Does your cousin have a webcam that I can get them
to? No, he does not. He would have to be typing.
Okay.
But I put out an ad and he wants to come, so.
Okay, let him come. That's fine. Hey, Barney Bay. How are you? Welcome to our Friday night round table.
I think he prefers Bernie.
Oh, yeah. Bernie, not Barney.
Yes.
Bernie. Sorry, Bernie.
Yes, isn't Barney a big purple dinosaur?
That I want to shoot. That I want to shoot right between the eyes with a sniper rifle while he's performing in front of a group of children.
You, Jesus.
Hey, Star, honey, we gotta let us chat.
Oh, he's a guest.
Let the trolling begin.
Actually, we only have one on here who's a guest.
Okay, there you go.
That's musical cue.
I think that may be my cousin.
Hey there, Zelda's cousin.
Hey, potentially Zelda's cousin.
Hello, Zelda's cousin.
Hello, Zelda's relative.
Guess can I... now so you can chat.
I know, sorry, somewhere in the process.
Somebody hasn't gotten it yet. What's the person who belongs to this one's apple group?
Oh, okay. Well, it's a pretty simple setup.
The Book of Proverbs tells you to always be ready to defend your faith. Thank you for coming.
So I've got some footage of the 40 Days for Life protests that have been going on. And I haven't put the video together yet, but it'll probably go up tomorrow or the next day. One of them is an old protest that I went to, and I'm still on their mailing list. They sent out pictures of their protest, and one of their signs, just like the Rick Perry ad, has an atheist A on it. And not only that, it's red.
Awesome.
Hello, Music Q, or Musical Q. Hi.
Yeah, that's my cousin. Yeah. I told him we were talking about abortion, and then later about, I think Dard said the Wall Street protests.
Yes. So, Musical Q, your stance on abortion?
He only wants to know if he can decide whether you're worthy of ridicule or not.
Do not ridicule my cousin.
We're ridiculing anybody. Besides me, ridicule someone?
Yeah, that's my job.
No, your job is to spread the Darwinian lie.
And I suppose I don't call people Sunshine, Cupcake, Sugar Tits, Sparky, and other assorted demeaning pet names along the way.
Okay. Musical cue.
Yeah, it's just incidental.
Incidental?
Do you think that the woman has a right to choose for herself? Happy Jesus, no Nephilim free references.
Mordecai says, yeah, she has the right to choose to have the baby.
Okay, Mordecai, can I just ask you a question? How much do you know about the process of pregnancy? I mean, if, for example, if I was to give you, say, the ectopic pregnancy scenario, what's your feeling about abortion in that instance?
Yeah, I have another question for Mordecai. Are there any circumstances in which abortion may be acceptable?
I.e. in the case of ectopic pregnancy.
So the punishment for abortion, according to musical cue, is religious guilt or life guilt. And that's a common theme that I've seen on some abortion protester signs, that they regret their own abortions.
Okay, Mordecai, I have a further question. When you say maybe if the mother was going to die, does that mean it's a coin toss if she's going to die? Or only if her life is in danger? Or would it also be acceptable if the mother was at risk for serious injury?
Good point, Happy Jesus.
Yes.
And are you familiar with what an ectopic pregnancy is?
Okay. William, do you want to explain the process of an ectopic pregnancy and the dangers therein?
Okay. An ectopic pregnancy involves when sperm goes up into the ampulla of the fallopian tubes like it's supposed to, and the egg comes down into the rest of the fallopian tubes or the oviduct, and instead of implanting in the uterus, it implants right there in the fallopian tube or oviduct and begins to develop. The mother's life is at serious risk. If something is not done, chances are that she will die from it. By the time she notices it, she may well lose a fallopian tube, if not an ovary.
How would she notice? Is this a painful experience?
Yes.
Very
okay. Uncomfortable, very painful experience.
My sister was in hospital last week with that.
Was she, Alex?
Sorry. Yeah, and they did have to remove the tube as well.
I'm sorry if that's bad news.
And it's a given that the baby's life is also in danger. And they can't just take it and put it into the uterus. They have to abort.
Okay, musical cue has actually said he doesn't think it should be illegal. He thinks it should be a choice.
Oh, hold on. Ryan, stop. Musical Q, are you a guy or a girl? This way we're not saying he or she and getting it wrong. Okay.
Oh, sorry. I wasn't sure if I used a pronoun.
I don't know if you want me to use your name, Musical Q.
Yeah, so like, we'll just call you Musical Q, that's fine. Just so that we don't say he or she and and look like idiots afterwards.
Well, we could always go gender neutral and refer to musical cue.
Oh, okay.
Well,
all right. Musical cue is Clinton. There.
Quentin.
Hey, Quentin. Mordecai just said you are talking about medical issues. But that is what abortion
pregnancy is.
It's
a medical issue.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of people lately who say
the majority of abortions after a certain time is a medical issue. It's when we can actually notice birth defects or complications that could cause the death of the child or the mother or both of them.
So Mordecai,
what do you mean they can be labeled a medical issue?
No, it is a medical issue.
Late-term abortions are simply medical issues.
Mordecai, are you sure that you still take a biblical stance as it concerns abortion?
We all know the Bible is not reliable when it comes to science.
Well, and there's a passage in the Bible which specifically commands abortion.
Yeah, it would it be okay if God told you to rip that baby from the womb and then dash its head upon the rocks? If God told you to do that, would you do it? You think it's absurd. It's in the Bible.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. Can you explain how that's being
misunderstood? Are we misunderstanding a direct passage that says that you shall take their women, cut open their stomachs, and dash their children against the rocks? That's what the passage says.
Wow, where is this in the Bible? I never heard that.
I think it's in Exodus.
If you believe there is a God, then most terminations are by him anyway. If you see what I mean.
So what was said and how we're understanding it is not the same?
Okay, elaborate. That's what we're asking.
Yeah.
Because that doesn't explain much more.
What context can you possibly think would make it okay to do that, and how can that context not be recreated today?
You know, the chat box and blog TV stuff.
Oh, hey, Stig.
Oh!
Wait, so because it's referring to a war situation, that's still pretty fucked up.
Yeah.
High stigma.
You know we have wars nowadays. You know that.
I'm referring to a passage which commands abortion even outside the context of war.
Mm-hmm.
Numbers chapter 5. If a husband suspects that a woman is pregnant by another man, he's to take her to the tabernacle, and the priest is going to scrape some dirt off of the floor of the tabernacle, mix it with some water, and force the woman to drink it. And if the woman has been unfaithful to her husband, drinking the water is going to force her to abort.
Yes. Musical cue, are you really saying that those parts of the Bible should just be ignored now, since the times have changed?
Well, so what, Stigmadine? If someone is attempting to use the Bible or use their religion in opposition to abortion, it needs to be illustrated that their god is opposed to abortion. If that's going to be used for the reasoning for prohibition of abortion.
And here's this guy brings up a good point that time should not matter.
So, Stigma Dane says what God commanded had nothing to do with an abortion. The act of taking a child from a womb and dashing the head upon the rocks is not abortion. It's a magical God declared act that you must do that does not count as abortion.
I think we established earlier it wasn't in war.
Abortion. The killing of unborn babies.
Other than worship, right, the time, I can't say.
Time matters.
Alright, I'm having a problem with something Stigma Dane mentioned here about how the times and society has changed. When the scripture supports what you want, you will defend it, even when someone points out that how society and times have changed. But when the scripture does not support what you want, you claim that society and times have changed, and therefore it's irrelevant. You just contradicted yourself on everything you've ever said.
Musical cue that could be directed as you as well. Like you're saying because societies have changed over time, then people need to reinterpret what is in the Bible, even though that it says something very direct.
And what happened to objective morality as well?
Listen to the overall message of God. Okay, then. The overall message of your deity says to kill people who do not believe in your God.
I don't see what that has to do with abortion specifically.
It's just,
What verse in Numbers is it you're going for, Chris? Stig's quite adamant that he needs the actual verse.
The actual verse, okay. The Numbers...
Chapter 5.
Chapter 5. Read verses 11 through 31. That is where abortion is specifically commanded, outside the context of war. I'll type it in the text chat. This is not the verse talking about dashing children against the rocks. I think that's in Psalm 137.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it's actually being written by an Israelite who's angry at the Babylonians for destroying the temple. You know, and is basically saying, asking Yahweh to dash the Babylonian children against the rocks as revenge. Yeah, I'm not talking about a psalm here, Stigma. I'm talking about part of the Torah.
So, also, I would like to add in Hosea chapter 9, where Ephraim prays that God will give his enemies miscarriages, and then God obeys him.
Headless, can you give complete rationality ops so that he can repost that link so that everybody can open it.
Thank you, Zelda. I was about to do that.
Yeah, love yourself.
Yeah, I almost want to pick somebody.
Now, I don't know if...
Where's the other buttons?
I don't know if you guys are going to count this as an abortion, because nowadays we would count it as a double murder, but also in Numbers, chapter 31 is Moses calling for the deaths of women who might have known a man, which means they might have been pregnant, which means that that could be a double murder, which is a form of abortion.
Now you're saying that because times have changed and the meanings of words have changed, that we need to reinterpret what those words are?
Who is that said, I'm God?
Okay, well, everybody hold on a moment.
Going on.
Okay, you're recording of part two.
Right, 2 Kings 8:12, which has been mentioned, you know, it's talking about something which another nation is going to do to the people of Israel. It's not a commandment for the Israelites to do the same to the other people.
Yeah, but in 2 Kings chapter 15, verse 16, God allows the pregnant women of Tapua to be ripped open. And,
yeah.
I'd say by his allowance of that, he is giving permission for it.
Yes, I would agree. Now, Stigmadine, can you tell me exactly where God's commandments have been written down? And Bernie Bay actually made a good point earlier, is that, you know, religious... Yeah. Why is it relevant whether the Bible endorses abortion or not? Shouldn't the pro-lifers supply a secular reason against abortion?
That's actually a really good point.
Yes.
Because if you just bring up religious reasons, then that doesn't mean anything to somebody who doesn't share your beliefs.
Correct. We live in a secular society.
I'm just now realizing that I don't think that it's a coincidence that Dara announced what topics we would talk about, and the only theist that we have that's brave enough that we all know was the Stigmadane, who will come talk to us about this. I think that there's a lot of Christians that could have been here.
Why do you really want to get into the whole morality topic? But you're going to have your ass handed to you if you do.
It's the Bible, so what? Talking to Mordecai.
It's the Bible. The Bible is just a book.
Stigmadane asks, does it matter when our government commands the military to bomb cities during war, killing kids anyway? Stig, there's a very popular phrase that goes, there are no atheists in foxholes. And that's not an admonition against atheists. It's actually an argument against foxholes.
I've heard that.
When the whistle blows, you go over the top. That's how it works, Stiggy.
Musical cue, you're saying it could completely be a man's decision. Do you realize that it's a woman's body?
He means, like, man isn't human.
Okay.
Not woman, mankind,
star.
Calm down, boy,
okay.
Calm down.
Okay.
Okay, Mordecai, yes, the Bible matters to Christians, and we've attempted to provide some illustrations where the God of the Bible, if interpreted literally, appears to command abortions, both in the context of combat and outside that context.
Okay, Stigmadane, the U.S. government or any government isn't telling you you're going to go to hell if you don't believe in them.
There are those of us who do complain about what the government does as well. Many of us will be at some Occupy Together protests tomorrow.
And if you don't like what the government's doing, you just wait 4 years and try and get rid of them by voting.
Right. And what is this, some kind of indictment against the government that they've done something wrong? Do we expect the government, which is run by people, to be perfect?
And is God allowed to be imperfect just because the government isn't perfect?
And this is one of the reasons why we get schisms and different sects and interpretations forming with religion. Because people think, well, hang on a second, you got that interpretation wrong. Our God isn't actually like that, so we think it means this, and then you get a split.
Yes, Mordecai, all that they did and I did was read you what the passage says. We didn't go deeper into it, we just read what the passage actually says. How do you go wrong with reading what a passage actually says?
Yeah, by deeper, are you saying that it's somewhat metaphorical? I mean, why would he have to paint such an ugly picture? That's ridiculous.
I agree with that statement.
Also, if you actually look into the theme of most of my videos, you'll see that it is actually the same point that I'm trying to make, is it's not about whether you are religious or not. It is actually about banding together to actually fix the actual problems by abandoning false teaching, whether it be religious or atheistic teaching. Not that there is such a thing as an atheist teaching, but you get the point.
We do have one commandment, Brian.
What, thou shalt not speak against the house of reason?
No, don't be an asshole.
Yeah, right, so exactly, that's my very point. The stupid exists in all walks of life, and it is the stupid that is the genuine enemy to all.
Okay, Stigmadane. People have explained this to you before. For there are many different interpretations that people have about the Bible. That's why in America alone, we have 30,000 different denominations of what they consider salvation to be.
I think it's funny that...
It's a debate about reason, rationality, and getting on with each other.
Yes.
I think it's funny that Stig says that it's about getting the real message of salvation, because I just argued with Brock Lawley and his Atheist Antidote video about how it was the moral thing to execute Troy Davis, and it seems like those people who would call themselves pure pro-life, as soon as a baby is born, would not give that baby free health care, not give it education... not give it food when it's hungry, and if it fucks up, maybe put it to death. So the only part they're pro-life on is actually the abortion issue.
That is your interpretation of what you think Christianity is. There's been other interpretations of Christianity where they persecuted a hell of a lot of people. One of the first four formations of Christianity persecuted the Jews, outright killed them, and made other ones convert to Christianity.
I'll add this, what Dar was saying. Stig, you're free to think that if you want. You're free to have your own opinion.
Can I add to what Michael said? Somebody on YouTube recently, I can't find the source, said that statistically, when abortion is illegal, you don't actually prevent any abortion. You don't save any embryos or fetuses, but you do kill women.
Okay. Again, Mordecai, do I have to repeat myself with you? There's many different denominations of Christianity, and saying that they weren't following the true doctrines of Christianity. What is the true doctrines of Christianity?
Exactly. How many are there? Are there over 30,000 or
38,000?
Just in the United States, there's over 30,000.
And just bear in mind while you're saying that they're not Christians, they're probably turning around and saying that you're not one either.
Yeah, that's so, exactly how it goes.
Yeah.
So if you really thought that was an argument,
So, Stigma Dan.
Mordecai, have you read the book of Revelation? If you're asking for scriptures where Jesus goes around killing people.
Do you believe in the Trinity?
Which is not in the Bible.
Stigma Dane has said in chat that Jesus was against persecution of anyone, especially those being condemned to death. And wow. I would put forth that Jesus in Matthew 11:20 condemned entire cities to dreadful deaths and eternal torment in hell. And if he wants to argue with me on that, or correct me in my thinking about how Jesus is condemning people to be dipped in blood and have swords sticking out of their mouths in Revelations 19, you know, or casting people in a lake of fire in Revelations 19. If he wants to correct me on this, this whole thing has been taped. So he can take this video and then, you know, make a video responding to it.
Yes, and also I would like to point out that character Jesus refers to the first set of Ten Commandments specifically about killing unruly children.
No, Stigma Dane, please. You take so much of the Bible literally, and now you're saying Revelations is not...
Well, that's okay for him to take the Bible not literally with Revelations. He's quoting Mark right there, 7:6. I'll quote right back to him from Mark and say Mark 4:11, where Jesus says that he speaks in parables so he won't have to save people so that they'll go to hell. Intentionally sending people to hell. And I would say that he can... make a response to that in a video if he wants, but,
Yeah, you know, Steve, I would really like to see you make a video on this, just blow everything we were saying out of the water.
Yeah, in Mark 16:16, he also says, "He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned." That doesn't sound like persecution in any way.
Well, obviously you're interpreting it wrong.
And what prophecy?
Oh, I must be.
Mm-hmm.
Mordecai, what prophecy? Mordecai, Jesus speaking in parables, and in parables was a prophecy?
He thinks it's in Isaiah.
Isaiah what? I have no problem looking it up and reading it. It's just that, you know, you need to be more specific.
Actually, he says that he came to fulfill the law, which granted, in context, is scripture, but this is where we're talking about interpreting things.
Okay, then. And according to Matthew 5:17-19, it's not until heaven and earth pass. That's when everything is fulfilled.
Wait, we could argue about this kind of stuff all night long.
Yeah, we could.
We could.
So, maybe we could ask Mordecai or Musical Q, you know, what reasons can you provide other than God doesn't like it for being personally opposed to abortion?
Yes. Thank you, Violently Graceful. Let's just move this along.
No, Happy Jesus. That's
no,
awful.
Happy Same. Jesus.
That was epic.
I don't know, if the Bible is good, then maybe abortion is good.
Yeah, I mean, it could be that they're both good. It could be that they're both bad.
Stigma Dane, you can send me a PM on Skype so I can add you to this call, or you can make a video response, and I will be sending you this video directly as soon as it goes live on YouTube, you know, because I don't want to just have all of us beat up on you, you know.
Okay, hold on.
Today's Friday Night Roundtable just happened to be theistless in the call.
Okay, I'll tell you what, Stick the Dying, where are you? Are you online? Okay, you're not online right now on Skype, but I will...
I don't know, Mike. I think there's been a fair representation of the theist position.
Okay, Stigma Dane, your
I would not say so. I think that we need to let them make their own arguments. It would be very straw man-ish if we were to say that we were just sufficient enough.
Okay.
Zalba trying to say something.
Musical Q, that's actually a good question. How about your feelings on that? If a woman was raped and became pregnant by that rape, do you think that that woman should get an abortion, or do you think that they should have a right to get an abortion? Because that was not a consensual act.
Or do you think biblically that she should get married to that man? Because that's what the Bible says about women that get raped. They need to marry that man.
And then pay the bride price for the woman.
Yes.
Wow. In what book does it say that?
It's
in Deuteronomy.
Yeah.
It's in Deuteronomy 5?
22.
Yeah, 522. 522 through 29.
Just past where it says that women shouldn't wear... pants.
Yeah,
they need to wear dresses.
And later has a point. We were giving personal reasons, not
yes,
biblical or whatever. If we're going to get straight back into the clusterfuck that we just got out of.
The Bible interpretation.
Avoid the clusterfuck, please.
I think this is the decision.
And yes, Mike, that was unfair.
Okay.
What was unfair?
Okay, musical cue. Next question. Okay. After 2 months of pregnancy, if after ultrasounds can actually be done to determine the health of the child, if a birth defect is found, like the heart outside of the body, or the skin condition that causes the skin not to form,
harlequin
I have a condition for you, a real-life situation from my own history, if you want it, Dan.
Okay, hold on.
Please.
In these cases... Okay. In these cases of birth defects that start developing after 2 to 3 months, and that's when we can actually tell what... Would you still force the woman to have the baby, or do you think that the woman should still have the choice?
He's already said he thinks she should have the choice.
Yeah.
He said that originally.
Okay.
Yeah, women should not be condemned for her decision.
Yeah, he said that a couple times. He thinks that it shouldn't be illegal.
Yeah,
okay.
I think the decision should be hers. No, I don't think she should marry that man, you inconsiderate bastard.
Okay,
it's in the Bible, right?
I can't see the full text.
Yeah, well, we're actually asking him for his opinion, not for what he thinks is in the Bible.
He actually asked a really good question at the thing, and this is when we first said, okay, no more biblical arguments because it turns into clusterfuck of the year. It was, he said, do you shed a tear when someone says they had an abortion? Do you feel a sadness? And he says, then is that God you feel, or is that just you? But I'm ignoring that. But then he went down to, do you feel differently if you hear they were raped and had an abortion?
I think the rape and the abortion would, that would be the one thing that would cause me to, you know, feel upset for her, or to shed a tear. I wouldn't necessarily feel upset if she, you know, said she had an abortion. I might go, wow, that kind of sucks. But, I mean, I wouldn't get upset about it necessarily. It just depends on the circumstances.
As I said, I have got a very good anecdotal real-life example for you, which is probably quite pertinent here. Because I actually did lose a daughter to a genetic disease that resulted in her heart not forming. Now, we discovered this at an age or at a time during the pregnancy during which an abortion was still legally and medically appropriate, and we decided that we would give her the best chance that she could, because it was possible that her heart may just be a little bit late in developing. As it turned out, her heart didn't develop at all, and she died in utero. So the end result was an exceedingly painful labor, which took my wife 24 hours to actually achieve, and we ended up losing the child in any case. But the one thing, the one saving grace, is that we know from the analysis of the waters and everything else that they did, that she died without any trauma whatsoever. He just stopped. So the one thing that really made the difference in our decision was whether or not my wife's life would have been at risk, and it wasn't. Other than that, the only way that I can get to terms with it is that that child just wasn't meant to be, regardless of what opportunities we presented, including 3 full open heart surgeries before she was 3 years old. Now that puts, it's a very personal perspective, but at the end of the day, what you have to bear in mind is that each individual situation is different. So you cannot pass blanket laws that are going to affect absolutely everybody, regardless of circumstance.
I think this is especially true with the shifting line that technology puts on this morality. My niece just had a baby where the intestines were outside of the belly when the baby was born. But it's only been in the last 20 years that they've been able to fix that with relatively no complications. And basically it's a bunch of stitches, a rubber band, and a plastic bag. And they use the air inside the plastic bag to force the guts back into the baby over the course of a few days. And the baby's fine now, just has a little scar. And 20 years ago, that baby would be dying a horrible death. You know? And you have to look at what's available in each time period, technology-wise, to reassess where you draw that moral line. And the person that's best able to make that decision about where the morals land now is the person that it's happening to.
I actually had a conversation similar to that about with someone recently, with like twins who were born attached to each other, and I was expressing how it might be okay to get an abortion because it seems as if you wouldn't want someone to live their life just attached, you know, like Siamese twins attached by their heads and other things, and in a way that could be terrible, but with modern day technology some of these things can be fixed, and yeah, it's definitely something to think about.
Your whole thing about God doesn't make mistakes. We said that we were going to try to leave the religion part out of this. So,
I would like to know how anyone thinks that God made any mistakes and it wasn't people that made the mistakes.
Well, I've just asked a question along that. How does our daughter's heart not developing fit into that argument?
Another example would be chromosomal trisomy, in which you have an extra copy of the chromosome. In a lot of cases, the conceptus, or fertilized zygote, spontaneously aborts, but often cases it can lead to debilitating birth defects, often leading to the death of the child immediately after birth. Would abortion still be okay with that, or does that still fall into people making mistakes?
Birth defects have been around for a long time, and why anyone considers that a punishment from God, I'll never understand.
Sorry, I do not consider what happened to my daughter a punishment from God to either her or myself.
Well, I didn't say you did. I'm just saying that there are a lot
I'm just making the counterpoint. That because some people do does not make it typical, and it does not actually answer the situation or the issue.
Yes, Dig, how, if that happened, how exactly was it man's fault? Or, could you repeat what you said before that?
Well, I want to know exactly what caused this, you know.
It was a genetic defect.
Okay.
Both my wife and myself have had previous kids that were healthy.
Even Jesus came across genetic defects.
What?
I'm not saying
he
didn't.
Healed a blind person who was blind from birth, so. I mean, there
are going to be genetic defects.
Paula, you've proved to me right now that the person that Jesus made sighted was blind since birth as a genetic defect.
Actually, it's mentioned in scriptures that he was blind from birth.
Because you can go blind from lacking minerals and vitamins in
your
diet.
That.
I don't think there's any...
Yes, musical cue. That's what we were asking you. Oh, okay. That's okay.
I don't think there's any data to review about the story of Jesus healing the blind man. The story says he was blind from birth.
Okay.
That's
now,
what we have to go by.
Here, I have another question for you. Okay. In Mississippi right now, they're trying to pass a law that will redefine what personhood actually is. And what this law will do will make abortions illegal. What do you think about that?
What about for necessary needs?
I think he answered that.
No, I didn't ask him about the Mississippi law.
No, a long time ago.
Stigma, for necessary needs, they said that in cases where the baby is unviable, they will work to save the mother. It did not say whether was in danger, if they would let her choose or not.
So they're not showing her any remorse for her continual damaged emotions and psychological...
Yep, pretty much.
You have quarreled after being raped, so you're not going to give the rape victim anything?
Oh, actually, no. Victims of incest and abortion, they do not allow, or victims of incest and rape, they do not allow abortion for either.
That sucks. Protesting.
Yeah, I am.
I don't think it actually does make miscarriaging capital crime, because in some instances there is nothing you can do about a miscarriage to stop it. So to make that a capital crime, I think, has actually been explicitly worded out of it.
Actually, in Utah, they tried to pass a law where they would investigate miscarriages to see if they were legit or if they were failed attempts at an abortion or something.
Well, yeah, I suppose.
I'm not sure if that law actually passed or if it was overturned at any point.
But the point with that qualification is that, you know, if it is a miscarriage over which there is nothing that could have been done to prevent it, then that would not constitute any sort of crime.
Okay, musical cue. What do you think about this push from the religious right to circumvent the law in Mississippi like they are doing?
He's saying he thinks it should not be a crime, it should be up to the mother alone depending on the situation, but not as a form of birth control. I agree with him.
Okay, that's fine. That's fine. That's understandable. Hi, serious
comment. Hi, guys.
Oh, hold
on. Okay, so...
I have to
restart
the recording.
Okay, I'll just go
and
get some more.
Oh, now there'll be evidence.
Actually, I do have a question for musical cue.
Okay, it's the recording of part 3 has started.
Okay. When you say a form of birth control, does that include situations where the mother simply cannot afford to have a baby at the moment? Like if she's 14 years old and pregnant? Or if she's in absolute poverty at the moment and just cannot afford to have a baby?
See, I took it to mean, like, continually having abortions, which, of course, is medically ill-advised anyway. I mean, you can end up making yourself infertile, yeah.
Right. But I'm just asking for an elaboration on that. Like, all does that entail?
Right.
Like, you're just talking about, you know, a loose woman who just goes out and gets them because she doesn't want to have a baby for convenience's sake, or does that include, you know...
And musical Q, you're more than welcome back to any of our shows. We do this every single Friday, and if you happen to get a mic and download Skype, we'll add you to the call.
Hey, if I could give my opinion on the poverty issue when it comes to abortion, I don't think that should really matter because adoption is very accessible, and
yeah, but prenatal care isn't necessarily.
Yeah, that often depends on the type of adoption you get. If you can find you're actually more likely to find a family willing to adopt your child while you're still pregnant, that will pay for the medical costs. But if you don't do that, and then you're like, I'm just going to use a safe haven law or give it up for adoption immediately after birth, it becomes an issue because then you've still paid for all those things. It depends on what service you use.
So, Stigmadane, when you say that it's immoral for people to casually have sex irresponsibly and then make life and then dispose of it like a used condom, is it immoral to give up a baby for adoption? That is, in a way, disposing of your responsibilities to the child. Or did he leave for
no,
a bathroom
call?
Break?
Oh, sorry. I don't understand why anyone would even ask that. As long as a parent is doing something responsible that is positive for the child's future, I don't see anything wrong with it.
There are some people who will be a surrogate and have a child for someone just for money without knowing whether or not the parents are really going to be good parents. And is that responsible?
That's up to the person that does it. I can't say if that's irresponsible or not without knowing every little detail about both parties' lives. You know?
Is it irresponsible?
It's not my place to judge them in the first place.
Okay. Is it irresponsible for people in Africa who have 12 to 20 children in a family, knowing that at least half of those children are going to die of starvation, and to just keep on having babies on the chance that they will have a baby that will live to adulthood and be able to start that cycle again. Is that...
Because of the fact of overpopulation and the fact that they are starving to death in poverty, yes, that was very irresponsible.
Okay.
Yeah,
even though they can't afford birth control.
I mean, look at the result.
Yeah.
But that's how they pass on their genes, because at least one of those children will grow up to be an adult and be able to have kids.
Passing on your genes and then throwing it in the dumpster because they're allowing it to rot away anyway.
Not intentionally.
That's
if they had enough food, they'd feed their kids.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's ill-advised for people to have, you know, dozens of kids. Now, I know they're doing a calculation, but I think the irony of it is if the problem is you're of starvation and then you go and you have 12 kids on the off chance that one of them will survive, you're literally making it harder that any of them will survive because you're dividing the food up against, you know, across more children. So,
yeah. And following that...
It's a commonplace practice, but it's not a good one.
Following that line of reasoning, is it immoral for the U.S. to ship medical supplies to Africa, knowing that we're just saving lives that are going to be hungry later?
Well, no, because in general, if we're sending medical supplies, we're probably sending food at the same time. So, and the problem isn't the fact that there's people in Africa. The problem is just there's not enough food for the number of people in Africa.
Well, there are whole charities that do not send food. They only send mosquito nets. And those mosquito nets protect children.
And there's others that send food. So, you know, let's not get ridiculous. Come on.
Well, we need to rethink the ratio that we're sending foods to nets with.
Well, that's right. The efforts need to be better coordinated better so that there's a proper balance between food and supplies and building supplies and everything else. Because... It you know, feeding everybody, you know, obviously it keeps people fed, but it's not long-term, additional needs to be done, and that's why I like things like, you know, Heifer International and things like that, Kiva, which are trying to, you know, help with the infrastructure, trying to give people some way to, you know, some means to feed themselves long-term as opposed to just giving them meals, because, you know, obviously, you know, giving someone a meal is a short-term solution. It's not a long-term plan.
And we also need... Sorry.
I'm sorry. You go ahead.
Oh, well, we also need, like, to be able to get them to use condoms without them thinking it's sinful. And also because education. Education's so important because, I mean, I used to work for Oxfam, and there was a terrible story that they'd gone back to a place they'd been earlier, and... They've literally been putting condoms onto bananas and then having sex. So it's like it's getting the condoms and knowing they can use them and also the understanding of what they do.
Yeah, so I agree.
That was actually along the points of what I was going to bring up. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, like I was going to ask musical Q and Mordecai, if he's still in the room, I can't tell. Are yous in favor of bringing back sex education and distribution of condoms and other contraceptions to bring down the pregnancy rate?
The other problem with the condom thing is that there's this cultural, I guess, sort of folk wisdom that condoms cause AIDS.
Well, no, that was passed around by the Catholic Church in
Africa. Exactly. Yep. Yeah, but there's also the belief that follows along with it that you don't need to wear one during sex, and the cure for HIV/AIDS is a shower.
Well, maybe they got that idea from the women that are allergic to latex touching their skin. Because I've met quite a few women like that.
They do make goats.
But if you're allergic, you find some other form.
Yeah, musical cue, the parts of the Catholic Church have passed around in Africa that condoms cause AIDS, and there's other groups saying that condoms are not effective.
That's
one of the biggest problems that we have right now with unwanted pregnancies and with spreading of STDs is that the sexual education has been severely reduced or removed from schools and is not being taught to people in our countries.
Czar and everybody else, I agree with you. I just want to point out that neither Fala nor Musical Q are representatives of the Catholic Church.
True.
So we can't. It seems like people are heaping that on them. To be fair,
okay.
It has nothing to do with that.
Okay.
To be fair, also there are certain evangelical Christian groups and certain Muslim groups spreading around the same stuff.
Yes.
So it's not like it's just isolated Catholics.
Okay.
Well, hold on a second. Wait. Mordecai just said, I wouldn't promote sex outside of marriage to any kid. No person should be pushing kids to have sex outside of marriage. I don't think anyone's saying, all right, you, go fuck that person. I think it's really more of understanding that kids are going to have sex.
Yes.
I don't think telling them to use a condom when they do it is the same as saying, hey, dive on in there, dude.
Yeah, and also no one has to push kids to want to have sex. Many of them want to do it on their own.
Yeah, hormones.
I wanted to. It wasn't very successful at the time, but I sure tried.
I agree with that.
Yeah, Musical Q, that's one thing that I try to push a lot is sexual education, but not like telling kids to go out and have sex. I would like the education back so that they understand what their bodies are going through, so that they understand what STDs are and how they're transmitted, to understand how pregnancies actually happen, and to teach them ways of preventing STDs and unwanted pregnancies.
In short, the condoms thing is pretty much, you know, hey, you don't have to have sex, but if you do it, be monogamous and wrap it up. If nothing else, wrap it up.
And I agree with you. All of that is really good stuff. Especially
yeah.
when you can get it all in one shot.
Yeah, hell, I think Trojan Condoms has a warning on the box saying, you know, the most effective method for preventing unwanted STDs and pregnancies is abstinence. But if you do have sex, we recommend a condom.
Right. Yep. My biggest problem...
Let's not forget that we are biologically predisposed towards propagation of the species. That's how it's inbuilt.
Yep.
Yeah, and I would say that I have something to say about that box, because they tried abstinence education here in Colorado Springs, and it didn't work.
That just makes it worse.
Yeah, and actually it wasn't just pregnancy that went up. It was chlamydia, too. And when they started teaching about condoms and birth control again in schools, the chlamydia rates didn't go back down. And so now all of the grandparents or would-be grandparents that were wanting their children to have abstinence education now can't have grandkids because their kids' junk has been messed up by chlamydia. Yeah.
Well, that kind of backfired.
You know, one thing usually when we talk about the abortion issue, obviously religion comes up a lot. But I do want to point out to everybody, religious and non-religious alike, that it really, at least in the U.S., it really wasn't until the 60s that it was even an issue. The abortion was not a big issue at all. And it was, and basically, I mean, the Catholics were probably about the only ones that were really against it. Evangelicals and other Protestants generally, it was kind of mix and match. It was not a big issue as it is today. So I'm not sure what caused that to change, but it did, and now obviously then it became political football that it is now.
I would say that might have something to do with the history of the eugenics program in America. The eugenics program didn't officially end until the 1970s, but early on in the eugenics program, things like abortions and Planned Parenthood were starting to kind of support that program. And once we'd kind of gotten away from that understanding of what eugenics was and how it was supposed to work, you know, it kind of evolved into a different situation altogether. At least I would argue that.
I'll have to look more into the eugenics programs of the 60s.
It actually started off as this attempt to get people to, with favorable genes, to propagate the population, spread the good genes around. And then eventually it turned into try to keep the retards and other social undesirables and immigrants from propagating in our borders.
You know, those pesky brown people.
Yeah. They could, up until the 1970s, if you were mentally handicapped and institutionalized, they could castrate you against your wishes.
Oh, not over here, they couldn't.
And, there was actually different immigration laws were passed in the 1920s due to the eugenics program, the Johnson Reed Immigration Act. You couldn't come over here if you weren't of a certain ethnicity or a certain part of Europe. If you were from too far east Europe, they actually stemmed the number of people that could come through. And if you were a quote-unquote social undesirable wrong ethnicity, if they didn't turn you away at the gates before they let you in, they'd cut your balls off.
Ouch. Ouch, quit it.
But, that's kind of a different story for another time. I'll keep this going into a tangent. Getting back on track.
I mean, how was that ever constitutional?
It isn't.
It was actually a mainstream political idea.
How was that ever constitutional?
It wasn't, but it's something that persisted through politics for decades.
Wow, in that situation, were you ever given the option to, like, go back?
Yeah, some of them were sterilized, burning ones that were already living in the United States. They did sterilize entire communities.
Well, and also too, Bernie, basically, there's not an awful lot of difference, at least for a male, between sterilization and chemical castration. They don't necessarily have to literally cut your balls out, but chemical castration and sterilization are basically the same thing.
The important part is you're losing the function of your balls.
Yep.
Look at the reality of it. In reality, we're just actually cloning ourselves.
What? Yeah, basically, for the most part, sort of. If we weren't diploid, we'd be completely cloning ourselves.
Yeah.
Have children, influence them.
But with our understanding of
influence them the same way.
With our understanding of mitosis and meiosis, we're not really cloning ourselves when we have children.
Plus, culturally,
Stig has a point, but biologically, definitely not. Not all the time.
Well,
remember,
personalities are genetic.
Certain aspects,
but not... But not overall.
Well, the reason why we're not truly cloning ourselves is because we have diploid cells.
The other thing is, during the process of meiosis, when the gametes, the sex cells, actually combine their genetic information, when they go to replicate, there's actually a process called crossing over, in which the chromosomes that are stuck together actually exchange genetic information.
Mm-hmm.
And for that sort of reason, that's another reason why you're not a perfect clone of your parents. That and the thousands of mutations that take place between each new generation.
Now, if we were haploid, we would be closer to being clones, correct?
Right.
But would you be identical to your father or identical to your mother?
To be more specific, I think if you were reproducing asexually, your offspring would be a clone of yourself.
Oh, okay. So it would be like Back to the Future. You'd look identical to your dad.
Pretty much.
Just as a personal observation, when I was a kid, I took after my mum like you wouldn't believe. Now I'm sort of very much taken after my dad, looks-wise. So over the years, I have kind of morphed, as it were, from one looking like one parent to looking like the other. And at points, I've also reminded myself of my grandfather and, you know, various other relatives.
I'm actually an image of my biological father. The features formed more so when I hit around 9 or 10. But it's when I kind of morphed into almost looking exactly like him.
I've got another interesting observation as well. My second wife, she has two daughters, both my stepdaughters, by different fathers, and they are like twins separated by a decade.
Wow.
I have my dad's skeletal structure and bad posture.
This happens.
I actually have recessive genes from two of my great grandparents on either side. I have the recessive blue eyes and blonde hair. Kind of skipped a generation with my mom and dad, respectively. But then my older sister, my younger sister, and I both have. Or all three have blonde hair, and my younger sister and I have blue eyes.
I'm confused by my sense of taste changing, or because I was the one member of the family who hated Marmite, and I've become a Marmite lover approaching 30. And also, my father used to love pesto, and I hated it. It was salty and oily, and as I get older, I've developed my dad's taste buds. I love pesto now.
That happens on most people when you get older.
Yeah. Actually, I've kind of noticed that too. As a kid, I used to hate cooked carrots and peas, and now I love them.
Okay.
They're not the first thing I reach for, but, you know, if they're in a stew or something like that.
Yeah. Our sensitivity to sweet increases as we get older, so as a result, when you're a kid, you love sweet, and you can eat things that are sickeningly sweet because you can't taste how sweet they really are. When as you get older, they become cloying, and you start to taste the sweetness in things like carrots and peas, so that's why they become more attractive.
Okay, that's
cool.
Right.
The taste.
Hey, everybody, people in the chat have already pointed out that we are way off the topic that we're talking
about. Oh, God, again.
Hey, from haggis to bratwurst.
Haggis is lovely, I have to admit. Ew. Anyway,
so it's something to do with abortion.
Which section of the program were we on?
We're about to stop the recording, restart the recording, and then start a new topic.
Okay, so why don't we have something culinary?
Yeah. Like, I'm gonna tell Alex how terrible I think Marmite... I've never actually tasted Marmite... But as a brewer, I have tasted spent yeast, so I really can't imagine it's much better.
Well, as someone whose mate is Marmite, I have to say it is one of the culinary moments of genius. Not only is it a good additive to recipes, but when you're pushed, it makes an excellent hot drink. And it goes excellent on a piece of toast with butter.
Mm.
Okay.
Yep.
How many people in the chat or
all
in the call have seen Ray Comfort's 180?
I have not yet. I've heard part of it.
I watched it last night.
I watched the first three minutes.
I got on.
I entered the chat, that's when I just got one, so I haven't seen it.
Okay, so...
I haven't watched all of it, but isn't the pretense of it pretty much... I know at the beginning he goes around asking people if they knew who Hitler was.
Right. Yeah, that's like the first 3 minutes.
The first 13 and a half minutes, don't mention abortion once.
Okay.
Yep.
Violently Graceful, can you go get my last video that I put up and link it into the Blog TV? Or get the link that I linked to the 180 movie and put that in into Blog TV? Prince, you saw the movie itself? Yes. Yes, it's 33 minutes long.
Bear with me.
33 minutes of propaganda.
Yeah, by the end of the video, the point is, if you think what Hitler did was bad, then why don't you think the same thing about abortion?
Because nobody's taking any sort of sadistic glee out of an abortion.
Right.
Anybody in their right minds, anyway.
Yeah.
An embryo is also where it's being killed.
And then it's really not just...
For everybody, the link that Violently Graceful just put into Log TV is the link to Ray Comfort's 180.
I've just put it in the chat.
Dumbest argument against gas gets into clumps in the Big Bang Theory. It's so comical that the site is putting stuff up here.
Okay.
And it's even an evolution site.
Okay, Prince Noob, I added you to... Yeah, okay. So you have seen it. Palace, I don't have you on Skype.
I don't have you on Skype.
You need to mute Blog TV, John.
Yeah, maybe we do Noob.
Or Palace, do you have Skype?
He does.
Stig, you said the Big Bang thing was on an evolutionist site?
It's evolutionistfacts.com, and I'm looking at the argument, and the argument sounds like someone that's, like, uneducated of any scientific formula to even understand it, to comprehend what the scientists are saying that it does.
Well,
to be fair, I can actually... comment on this a little bit. My mentors actually brought up on a couple of occasions in his videos that there is a sort of, I don't want to call them a fringe group because I don't think that's fair, but there's a group of scientists that don't believe the Big Bang actually took place. They believe the universe is static, that it's always existed, that there was no bang or anything of that nature.
I mean, you know, the Big Bang doesn't actually say that there was nothing in the beginning. That's like a common misconception. Like everything was condensed. Everything was condensed.
There were several events, even at the same time. Some of them.
Right. These people believe that there was no. These people believe that there was no point of origin. That, you know, there was no quantum singularity.
Well, the blankness space has always existed.
Yes, thank you.
Well,
the stars' galaxies have always been that the cosmic radiation is just. That's not leftovers of the Big Bang. That's just an aspect of the universe or something like that.
How do they explain the current expansion?
The
universe could be a lot more older than 20 billion. It could be a lot more older.
The problem is that we can't regress any further beyond the point of singularity. But there is theories that, you know, kind of explain that the universe may well have been around long before the Big Bang in some form or another, France had existed for a time as a singularity before the Bang. Perhaps there have been multiple Big Bangs throughout this universe.
And it could quite well be
that this is
a quantum event that happened inside an existing universe that has since been pushed beyond the boundaries of ours.
Yes,
I see that. There are many, many theories.
How do we get to this topic?
I would like to throw into this topic randomly. It could be that we're like carried around on the backs of four elephants on top of a giant turtle.
I have to agree with that.
Okay,
we've never seen the other side of the earth.
I'm riding on the back of a crater.
Okay.
Turtle.
Everybody.
Exactly.
Okay, I'm gonna start the recording of part
four.
We're just
gapping here. Sorry.
I think it could just be scientists conspiring against religion.
I just want to say, I don't know who to thank, but I apparently got a mention or a thumbs up somewhere because I've got a sudden minor influx of subscribers over the last couple of hours. So whoever did that, if you're in the room, thank you.
No wonder these arguments are like from the 70s and 80s.
Okay.
Well, if nothing else, Steve, it should give you some measure by which to consider their writing.
I just think it's really funny that I found this. These are really
good. I'm wondering if this site is actually made by people who accept evolution, because I'm reading the sidebar here and it says
here. I'll put the link in if you want me.
Yeah, go right ahead. I'm reading here on the sidebar. It says, like, the ex-atheist experience. Atheists cannot provide proof or evidence that atheism is accurate and correct. It doesn't really sound like... Well, first, it wouldn't even belong on a site related to evolution, and two...
right.
That's the page I'm looking at.
Yeah. It just seems like... and then there's, like, atheism is dead, unhappy atheists, so... I have a feeling that this is a post site made by people who are trying to discredit evolution.
Okay, guys, can we go back to the topic that we were trying to talk about?
Well, abortion. Going to a new topic, I guess.
Abortion.
Yeah, we're going to start talking about the 180 movie. That's why I added new sauce to the call and asked people if they saw it.
And it's why it's linked in the title of the chat.
Yes.
Okay.
Then I'm sorry.
Somebody earlier on mentioned in the chat that the first half of it was a good piece on the actual Holocaust.
I would say that for the people that Ray Comfort found that did not know who Hitler and what the Holocaust was, that would have been something that would have just made a good little mini movie by itself.
Right. Yeah. I thought it was very interesting that all the people he interviewed like did not know who Hitler was or what the Holocaust was.
Well, so. There's some Paul C. Hartley found that at least one of them was reading from a cue card.
Yep.
So,
I saw that.
He could have been doing that for weeks as well.
Yeah, it seemed a little fake in parts. Like
yeah,
the contract
I'm,
after story.
I'm fairly certain he found people that were like, of course I know who the fuck Hitler is. And
yeah.
He edited them out. I guarantee.
If you interview enough people, you will find someone who will give you the exact answer that you want.
Yes.
Yeah, and all you have to do
just
leave out the ones you don't want.
Yes, and I find that disingenuous of him because I'm sure that he got more than enough replies refuting what he was trying to say that he just did not believe that.
I actually find it very interesting and telling, even though, yes, there may have been one or two that were reading off cue cards for an ice cream or whatever, but I do find it telling that he did manage to find so many people that were or claims to be unaware.
Have you ever seen The Tonight Show and the segment called Jaywalking?
Yes. Oh my goodness.
No.
I will admit that I am sure that there's people out there that don't know who Hitler is. Hi, Death of Speech, welcome to the show. That don't know what the Holocaust was. And for those people, I want to hit them with a history book. And like,
Before you do, AV123 does make a very, very valid point in the chat room by pointing out that those that Ray carried on the abortion conversation with did know who Hitler was.
Is that AV Owens in the chat?
Is it? Hi, AV.
It could be.
Well, it's AV123. And
okay, hold on.
Over.
Okay. Musical cue. We're segueing in from the abortion topic into Ray Comfort's 180 movie, which is linked right above the chat.
AV Owens, you have been added to the Skype call.
Well, hey there, AV.
Just turn on your Skype and we will add you to the call.
Or you can join.
Musical cue. If you click the link that is above the chat, that will take you to Ray Comfort's 180. If you click the link,
that is the whole movie.
It will open up his movie into a new tab for you. It is a 33-minute movie. And we're going to start talking about it.
Okay.
Okay, so
just as a production thought, Dar, for future roundtables, when you're going to go through a movie, in the promos that you do for it, it might be worth priming people with the link and saying, "There you go, watch that," because that's what we're going to. Oh, did you? Oh, well done.
Yes, I did.
That
was true. I think I got it.
That was the addendum video.
Yes.
Ah, well done. Okay.
Actually, I reminded him.
Yes.
He didn't do it at first.
I will put my egg-sucking tutorials away then.
Okay.
Suck eggs, Redcoat.
I really think that Comfort guy, he could really talk about anything he wanted to and make people believe what he wants them to. He's just really, really, really good at talking. You know, he's an excellent salesman, absolutely right.
I think he could probably turn any topic into getting people to agree.
Yeah, absolutely.
You should be the new Billy Mays.
I think he's got a box of tricks, and I wouldn't put up with it. I'd say, no, if you want to sit down and discuss this properly, fine, but don't shove a mic in my face and do these stupid tricks.
Yes. But,
I think if you had more than a couple of brain cells to rub together to make a coherent thought,
yeah, he was picking and choosing his targets, I think,
yes.
For sure. Pretty well.
Welcome to the Friday Night Roundtable.
Hi, Abby.
Hello.
Thank you for joining us, because Stigma Dane makes a horrible token Christian.
Okay, so the first 13 minutes of his film, he goes on about Hitler and the Holocaust. And that's also when he is asking people about the Holocaust. What did you people think about that first 13 minutes of it?
Well, the first 13 minutes, I don't know exactly what the first 13 minutes were, but basically when he was informing people who apparently did not know what the Holocaust was. It was a pretty good depiction of Hitler and what the Holocaust was. So in the beginning, I didn't really have too much of a problem with what he said, but as the video progressed, you know, it just wasn't that great.
I had a different reaction. I had to stop after the 3-minute mark. It's just like, and within that 3 minutes, I didn't have a lot of faith for the rest of the video.
Yeah, it was pretty weird. I watched the entire thing, and it was kind of interesting that everyone thought Hitler was a communist. I thought that was kind of...
Yeah, just interview right-wing dumbasses, and yeah, sure, you know, you'll get that reaction. Hitler was a communist.
Socialism and all of its...
Hitler was more like a Calvinist Catholic with old Germanic Norse and Aryan doctrines.
Yep.
In short, he was a dictator.
Yep.
Okay. Too much pen thing, Black.
Kind of like what? An asshole pen.
I'm open to correction, but I think the Vatican did not actually condemn and demonize Hitler until after the war.
I think you're right.
Yeah.
During the war, he had papal support.
Yes, he did.
Yeah. He was buddies with Pope Pius VII, I think.
Well, how could they stop me?
Condemning his actions.
Through papal seal? Is it called a papal bull?
How could they
do
this?
Papal bull.
They could have excommunicated him.
Yeah.
Yeah, they could have raised hell if they really wanted to. They had more.
Removing support would have been good enough.
Most of the Nazis were Catholic, so wouldn't they have said, oh, well, if our Pope hates Hitler, then...
Okay. More attack?
Yeah, very much so. If Hitler had been excommunicated, he would have lost all of his Catholic support.
Okay.
Yep.
Hey, then Hitler was a Catholic, and Catholics are Christians.
Okay.
The other thing is that
him a Christian.
That's not to say that his actions were Christian actions. It's just the fact that he did believe in a Christian God. He was a Catholic.
He also invoked God's inspiration for. He also invoked God and Christ for his actions.
Gott mit uns.
He claimed in speeches and in Mein Kampf that genocide of the Jews was retribution for killing Christ. By defending
Mordecai,
himself, too, I believe that I am defending myself.
You are doing, like, textbook No True Scotsman. Seriously.
Yeah, I've actually heard and read the same thing, Ebo Jim.
Yes, you are. They were Christian.
That is not to say that Hitler did not follow a warped, distorted, very personally biased, politically laden version of Christianity.
Yes, but they were Christians, and they are. Doesn't matter if you don't like it, they are Christians.
He's a shitty example of a Christian, but, you know, he wasn't a Christian. Yeah.
Well, fascist ideologies are kind of made from things like sewn together and that don't work together. Because, I mean, Hitler talked about evolution, but he didn't understand it. But in Mein Kampf, he actually refers to Adam and Eve as historical figures. So, I mean, the man was just mad.
Furthermore, as an item of historical note, with regards his anti-Semitic policies, there was pretty universal or widespread support throughout Europe, albeit that it wasn't until they saw what actioning those policies did post-war that they turned around and suddenly backtracked on the whole thing.
Yep. Okay. Well, because, I mean, anti-Semitism was rampant.
Anti-Semitism was rife in Europe at the time. Hitler just took it one step further, that was all.
Yep.
Okay, they can claim that they followed Christ all they want. They didn't. That's their fault. You know what? You know nothing of history at all. The history of Christianity at all.
Nazism is popular in the USA. That's one worrying fact of modern life.
No,
there was
not,
also a little bit of support for Hitler in the
US. Who are you yelling at here?
Not you,
Mordecai.
Mordecai. I'm yelling at Mordecai right now.
Oh, okay.
Did you want to join in the fun?
Look, okay, if and when anyone gets as sick of Mordecai as I am, may I please have first dibs on kicking his ass?
All right.
Well, fair, he hasn't been trolling. Just
yeah. I say let him speak unless he just starts saying.
Yeah. Really irritating. I don't even mean kicking
him out. Irritating or not.
He's not a troll if he actually holds the position.
Irritating or not, he is within topic. He's just in disagreement. There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah, we thank you for coming, dude.
Yeah, if he turns dickish, feel free.
Okay, but getting back to the 180, Ray Comfort goes from talking about Hitler and the Holocaust and goes right into abortion without giving the people time to coordinate themselves.
That's on purpose.
Yeah, that's how Ray operates. It's tricky.
Hey, together. Yeah. Oh no, that's not together for peace.
No, it's together for tacos.
Oops, I just saw the together F, and then it's like together for peace, and then scrolled over the name. Was all like, oh no.
He has Sorry, been bro. A guest.
Okay. Amy Owens, since you're new to the call, would you like to talk about what you thought of Ray Comfort's 180?
Well, I don't know, I guess I'll just listen for now, and if I have any objections as to what you guys are saying, or agreements, then I'll...
Well, we're giving you the floor right now for your own honest perspective of what you thought of the 180.
Well, clearly I'm Christian, so I thought it was pretty good. I don't agree with... I don't agree with the idea that Ray Comfort is a car salesman, or that he disorients people with argumentation before he, just a few seconds ago, somebody said that before anyone had a chance to orient themselves, he went right into the abortion topic, and I don't see why he would need to give people who are against this understand who Hitler is and what he's done and the context of evil from a secular and from a Christian perspective. What kind of orienting do they need to be able to make the connection between the dehumanization of Jews, which led to genocide, and the dehumanization of the fetus or the unborn child that leads to the genocide of children in the West. I thought it was a pretty good video. I mean, he didn't really lay out any sort of objective morality that people can reference. But I mean, other than that, I thought it was pretty good.
Okay.
The idea that, metaphorically speaking, he's not a car salesman, I'll probably have to disagree, because he could have made that video entirely without mentioning anything about Christianity. He took some time to explain to people, you know, the word of God and things like that. He could have just completely left it out. So I see that sort of as a way to try and shine light on Christianity.
Well, of course. I mean, what's the point of being Christian if we're not going to base our beliefs on our Christianity, if our justification for doing anything isn't our Christianity? I mean, what's the point?
The entire video had nothing to do with Christianity, but I'm telling you, that's what part of the video was.
He presented the Gospels, which I think is necessary if you're ever going to have a discussion as a Christian with a secular individual. I mean, that's what Christians think are necessary. It is necessary. So it's just probably a different point of view atheists have with Christians as to how we're supposed to have conversations about any given topic. That's what I think.
I thought what was very Christian was the way he used Hitler was to make morality look black and white, which it isn't. And that's a big problem people have with religion, is that very black and white view of morality. And also, I think that using Hitler was very, very hateful, particularly some of the images that we used.
Which is very what?
Okay, what did you think about him? Okay, he brought up Hitler and the Holocaust. He put people's minds in thinking about what happened, which was genocidal, to a group of individuals. And then immediately after they're thinking that way, bringing up abortion.
Are you asking me personally?
Yes. Yes.
Oh,
I'm asking you.
Well, you have to put them in perspective. I mean, if you're going to just
But how is that putting it in a perspective? Abortion and genocide are completely
different. They're the same thing.
Yeah, but nobody goes around talking about exterminating fetuses.
Well, yeah, they're similar in one sense, but the complexity of abortion is different than that. When you look at the Holocaust, you can just look at it and absolutely say that it's a no-brainer, that it was wrong. But when you look at abortion, it's really not exactly the same thing.
I mean, well, the Germans who were in 1940... Germany wouldn't have been able to look at the Holocaust and black and white said that it was wrong, like we're having issues with abortion. They would have just as easily thought that exterminating Jews is a not a black and white issue. There's rape parts.
1941, Hitler had targeted the Jews because of their oppressive maneuvers on the economy of Germany.
But what is that? Like, so he had his reasons.
They were taking jobs away from the Germans.
The Germans.
But what does that have to do?
So Hitler decided to terminate. That's exactly what happened.
Well, abortion doctors aren't trying to conquer the known world either.
Okay, I didn't get that last one.
You didn't want anyone in Germany that wasn't German.
Well, what does that have to do? Hitler had his reasons for committing genocide, and the women in the West have their reasons for supporting
genocide. I would say comparing a blob of cells no bigger than your fingernail to genocide of people is not an accurate one. Yeah.
Well, the Germans and Hitler didn't believe that Jews were human either. So,
that a Jewish person is indeed a human being and a person. So,
okay, the issue of abortion is not based on whether someone is a human, but that is how Ray Compton was making it seem. There's more to it than that. And one more difference I would like to draw is that, going back to what I said earlier, we can look at that and say there's absolutely no justification, but there are instances when abortion where, you know, it might be warranted. So.
No, well, obviously
Hold on. Before we go
can
on,
I?
You came into this conversation pretty late and you don't know your stances on abortion, so you don't mind
can
taking
I,
minutes.
With that in mind, Phil, can I ask Avi a question that was asked earlier?
If she's the only other, Christian in the room, let's compare mine to hers.
Okay.
Yeah. I would be very interested in your opinion on a pregnancy such as an ectopic pregnancy.
Okay. Before we go there, Brian, let's get her own personal views on abortions. Because she just came
absolutely.
To the wall. And have her point of view. So AVO runs, if you can take like 2 or 3 minutes and tell us your stance on abortion.
My stance on abortion is that it's never okay. rape, incest, it's never okay. It's that simple. And do you want my reasoning as to why I think it's never okay to have an abortion if you're raped or as a result of incest?
Yeah, I'd love to hear that.
First, I don't think we should, the argumentation for, I guess, pro-abortionists is what about the rapists? What about those who are raped and those who have children as a result of incest? And the fact is, I think like less than 3% of all abortions are a result of incest.
That's irrelevant. No, you're still, that has nothing to do with whether or not it's right to do that or not. Please answer
that question. I'm not done. Okay, so So from that perspective...
I'm going to make the comparisons that I'm going to stop you and answer the question.
Well, let's finish, Joe.
Okay, so from that perspective, it's not good enough justification for our society to legislate for abortion for the 3% of people who are having who have been raped or have been pregnant because of incest. The reason why I don't believe that women should be able to have an abortion as a result of rape is because why would we punish the innocent child for what the guilty father did?
Why would we punish the woman? What does that have to do? We're not punishing the woman.
Yes,
you. In some cases, someone feel they're being punished. That would be a punishment. That would be so anathema to them, to their very being. You're telling them, "Screw you. You have to have this child, you want it or not."
To remind you of what was done to you.
Only because we give them the option of having an abortion, why it even seems that way. If we had a society where we didn't believe that rape was a good enough reason, if we valued life beyond our own feelings, then it wouldn't be an issue. I don't believe that a woman should be able to take out her frustration, her anger out on an innocent child.
Okay, how many times have you been raped?
Guys, everybody stop.
Zara is saying stop. Okay, Zelda would like to respond to A.B. Owens. So, Zelda.
Okay, I'm going to try to do this in a non-yelly way.
Okay.
The thing with rape is that you're not, with abortions in cases of rape or incest, where you're saying that there are so few, that doesn't calculate in. We have a lot of things set in place to protect the rights of the minority.
Okay, but I said that is not justification enough for us to legislate for abortion. There is not a legislation for abortion in place.
It's just legal. The thing is that with the thing for not making cases an exception of rape, you're saying, why would you punish the unborn child? And Siri said, why would you punish the woman?
We're not punishing the woman. The rapist is punishing the women, and you put them in jail, or we punish them in whatever way we deem necessary. It's the rapist's fault. By us saying that it's not my fault that she's pregnant and the belief that she should continue to have the child, it's not, what does that have, like, I don't want to sound callous, but what does that have to do with me? It's
Avi, the punishment. It doesn't have anything to do with you. That's the point. It's not your choice. The
it
thing
shouldn't
is,
be a choice in the first place. Just because we've been able to label it choice, just because we're able to give women that choice, it doesn't mean that it's a legitimate choice.
Avi, that option has been around since BC. Just because it wasn't done in a doctor's office.
Yeah, and murder has been around
since
a woman responsible, financially responsible for a child she didn't want, that's not punishing her?
Okay, if somebody chops off my arm, that's something I'm going to have to live with for my whole life. There's absolutely nothing I can do about
it. So you're saying that we can't have prosthetics.
Hold on, guys. If someone cuts off your arm, there is something you can do about it. It's called go to the doctor or hospital quickly, and they probably could put it back on.
Okay, but obviously that's not the situation I'm talking about in the instance when I would never be able to replace my arm. And prosthetics is a substitution. Adoption is a substitution. You don't have to use
Dark, can I ask one more question and then I'll shut up?
Okay then, and then it goes to Evo Chan.
Okay.
I really need to respond to that, please. More.
Well, it goes to Evo.
I get to next, Kevin.
Alright. Yeah, so one of the things where we say it's one of the reasons why a lot of people think that it's punishing the woman is, do you understand the emotions and things that come along with being pregnant? With carrying a child to term, even if you want that child, the emotions that go along with it. If you had that child not of your own will, if you became pregnant from something like rape or incest, yes, you may be happy that you're pregnant. You may love your child, but you may not want that necessarily also. It's like saying, hi, you got violated once for however long, so we're going to continue to force you to be violated for the next 9 months. Have a nice life. That's kind of fucked, whether they give up for adoption or not.
Okay, but the use of the word force is,
yes, force.
Not very fair, because I don't believe it's a choice in the first place. If it would be forced, if you had the choice to have an abortion, if abortion was a legitimate choice, and it's not.
So taking away someone's choice isn't then forcing them into whatever alternative.
You don't have the choice. It's not a legitimate choice. It's almost like me giving someone the choice.
Who says
who? Says I do.
Does anyone mind if I ask a question?
Go on. If you saw, I said that you were after arsenic, and then Fala is after you, and then Mike is after Fala.
Okay. Amy, do you mind if I ask a personal question?
Oh, not at all.
Feel free to ignore the question if you feel it's too personal or too over the edge. But have you yourself ever been raped?
Obviously not.
Okay, so how can you comment on the situation of a raped woman?
Because the belief that I hold is that abortion being wrong is objective. It has nothing to do with what I feel like. My morals are not determined by what I feel. It's what is objectively true, and abortion is wrong. That's what's objectively true to me.
Okay, well, that's your belief, but how does that add credibility?
Well, your belief that a woman should have an abortion has no more credibility than mine. If we're just, like, obviously I can't bring God into this conversation because not everybody in this room believes in God. So just as you are entitled to your belief that women should have an abortion and entitled to state it without actually having any sort of credibility,
Hold on. I don't believe that a woman should necessarily get an abortion. I believe she should have the choice to. And part of that is medical reasons for getting it, like the ectopic pregnancy, where the conceptus actually implants itself in the fallopian tubes instead of the uterus. Or, say, something like chromosomal trisomy, where oftentimes the baby dies shortly after coming out or shortly before.
But this kind of thing has been happening for all of human history.
But then you said, you know, abortion shouldn't be allowed. So if the mother's life is endangered, or the child's life is going to end prematurely anyway, I think the woman should have the opportunity to, at least in those circumstances, choose whether or not she wants to have a baby. And in circumstances of rape or incest, I also believe that she should still have that opportunity to choose.
Okay, A.B. over...
I'm going to go ahead and be fair and say that my opinions on the matter are just that, opinions. But what you're doing is asserting your opinions as fact.
Well, they are fact.
Hold on. Okay, recording.
I'm stating them as fact because I believe they are fact. You may believe that they are my opinions, and that's fair, but I believe that an abortion is wrong, which is objectively true. And I'm going to actually rephrase that and say I know that abortion is wrong, is objectively true, because of my beliefs.
Can you prove... Okay, then that's your back and forth. Follow was...
Actually, I do have one last question, if that's okay.
Okay, last one, and then it goes to Follow, then to Mike, then to Brian... Then to Zelda.
Just this one last question, I promise to step off the soapbox, but A.B., when you say that abortion should not be allowed, period,
mm-hmm.
when the mother's life is in danger, as she'll die if she carries that baby to term, are you still saying that the mother should be forced to carry the baby to term if she or the baby is going to die as a result of the pregnancy?
Mothers and children dying because of pregnancy has been happening for all of human history.
But
I don't think, like, let's say the ectopic pregnancy, for example, that would be a medical procedure. That wouldn't be an abortion, where a doctor is ending the life of something because somebody just don't want it.
Technically, with the ectopic pregnancy, what they do is they remove the entire fallopian tube. And unfortunately, they have to abort the conceptus or the fetus that is formed there. It's going to die anyway. And once you remove it from where it is implanted, you can't put it back.
And that's why I said that would be more like a medical procedure, where it's an pregnancy. It's an impossible pregnancy. It's not something like rape or incest, where a woman is putting her feelings above what is objectively wrong.
I could respond to that, but to be fair, I think it is Fala to show his turn.
Fala, you've been waiting.
First, I have a question for her that I need to ask before I give my opinion on abortion. What was her name? Avi?
Yes, Avi.
Okay, Avi, do you believe that Jesus was a rational, logical person?
Well, considering that he's God, yes, I do.
That's not a good reason to say that.
Well, if God is the greatest conceivable being, he would be the most rational, most everything that you listed, and if Jesus is God, then therefore he would be what you said.
In that belief, anyone could believe it as a Christian that way, but I'm saying what he said and why he said it. Do you believe that was a logical thing to do and irrational thing to do?
What he says in the Bible, the gospel? Yes, of course.
Okay, now, I just wanted to know that. That's all I wanted to know. Do you think that it's a very logical, rational thing to allow a parent to be burdened with the thought of a child being raised, they have to raise a child that was forced upon them? First off, they're sexually violated, and they have to live with that resentment. Are you going to, like, do you think it's rational to psychologically damage that person to have to go through that pregnancy? And even, do you think it's a rational thing to do to prevent anything happening where the parent could easily abuse the child out of resentment, which would prevent it from succeeding in life?
Okay, well, first, like I said, the raped mother, her only option is not having to raise the baby. She could give it up for adoption. And my second point is that I wouldn't be forcing her. It would be the rapist, and we would punish him for doing that. The rapist is at fault for whatever.
Still punishing her. And
the rapist,
even afterwards,
abortion is not a legitimate choice. Okay, so if
I don't believe it is either, and I really agree that it should only be used for necessity, and not because of someone's careless irresponsibility.
But the way you phrase the question, as if I was the one forcing the mother to go through all of that emotional trauma, and I'm not the one doing that,
the person that votes for that kind of thing to be in your society, don't you think you're attributing to that?
No, I'm not, because abortion is not a legitimate choice.
It's a necessity. It's a necessity.
No, you believe it's
a logical, rational necessity in society.
No, you believe it's a necessity. I don't believe it's a necessity.
So in other words, we're just going to allow... Can I carry a pregnancy? We're going to kill her, is what we're going to do if we don't help her.
No, we're not. I'm sure the number of women who... this is just an opinion. Like, this is just a bold face and opinion. But we don't know the number of women who have had... who's been raised and have children they've loved and grown up to be something great. We don't know. I don't know. Do you know of any research done about women who've been raised and had to raise their own kids versus the number of those who've been emotionally traumatized because of being raped and having to raise kids? I mean, this is just...
We don't have those...
It's a lot of statistics suffer.
Here.
She's already suffered by being raped. That's the punishment of the rapist. That's what he's being punished for, not the fact that he's impregnating her.
Well, yes, he is. He's not, may not be punishing
her. He's being punished for the sexual violation of her.
But her emotional trauma would still be his fault. It wouldn't be my fault. And if abortion is not a legitimate choice, then the trauma she's going through is something that she must grow through as a result of what the rapist did to her, which is wholly his fault.
Let me give you a little bit of that. It's necessary in society to allow it as the choice of the mother to prevent any psychological damage of the mother or the child.
No, not at all, because
that's a very logical thing to do.
No, it's not, because people go through emotional trauma for various things, and if we are going to say that a woman can have an abortion simply to avoid emotional trauma, then what else? I'm allowed to sue my mother for the various things she's done that caused me emotional trauma. You're allowed to
sue the bully. So basically, you're being apathetic towards a victim that was violated sexually. And you're going to say, no, you can't get an abortion. You have to raise that child, no matter if you love it or not.
Where you cannot guarantee that everyone is free from emotional trauma. That is just reality.
But
you don't then try to compensate for that.
Do not try
to compensate for that reality by allowing mothers to murder her children.
Can I throw in another question here? Just quickly.
What?
Anyone has a second life is going to pay.
If we are going to assume that there is going to be an associated guilt concerning the baby's life, would it not be fair to put that guilt also onto the rapist rather than the mother?
In the U.S. and a lot of states, it is that you actually find rapists if they are actually let loose in society. He has to pay for any medical damages.
I didn't understand the question.
The point of the question is, there seems to be a great emphasis on piling the guilt concerning the loss of the baby's life onto the mother in terms like murdering her child. Does it not actually make more sense to put the guilt, if there is some associated with the loss of this life, onto the rapist's head as he committed the crime rather than on the mother's head? And can we not, in an enlightened, medically competent society, can we not utilize those skills to ease the suffering of the mother and preventing the suffering, potential suffering of that child? And do you not think that he would approve of anything that we can do to prevent such human suffering?
By he, you mean God?
Yeah. And Jesus specifically.
Okay, your first point was, shouldn't the fault of, I guess, the abortion be also placed on the father?
The rapist.
The rapist.
Yeah, rather than the mother.
Well, I guess so, but at the same time, like I said, I believe abortion is not a valid choice to begin with. So the mother who has the abortion, that's like her choice to do something that isn't valid.
I would agree with you insofar as if it's an arbitrary choice being made for the purposes of birth control, I would agree with you totally. But when it comes down to it being a life-saving medical procedure or something to prevent suffering or prolonged suffering as a result of a crime, then it falls into a different category altogether.
But at the same time, we all experience suffering, and we all could blame someone else for our suffering. Like I said, the reality that we live in...
Sorry, forgive me if I misunderstood you, but it sounded to me like you were kind of absolving the rapist by saying we cannot hold him responsible for his crime and the results and connotations and consequences of that crime.
Well, no, that's not what I'm saying at all. Of course the rapist is responsible. Of course the rapist is responsible for raping the mother and getting her pregnant. But does that then justify the mother to relieve her suffering by committing a crime, which I believe is murder? I don't think that we are justified in using morally wrong actions to relieve our suffering.
Okay, what if the victim of that rape was a 10 or 12 year old girl that is actually mature enough to conceive, but not yet physically mature enough to carry a baby to term?
Then we'd have to decide it on Sharia law.
Oh my God. Let's not go there, dude. That just completely trashed the valid question. Thanks.
By mature, you mean if she has a baby, she'll die.
Physically incapable of carrying a baby to term.
Well, I'm hesitant to say anything, not because I'm about to go back on my belief, but because I don't know how to phrase my belief so that it doesn't sound wholly callous.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can we at least agree that I've given you a scenario that gives you pause for thought?
Yes, insofar as that it doesn't make me go back on my belief, it just makes me...
But it does at least make you reconsider them.
Well, not reconsider, no. It just makes me have to better think out how I would apply this to real life. If I had to be the one to tell the 12-year-old mother...
But as yet, you don't have an answer for it.
No, I don't have an answer for it. No.
Okay, that suits me fine. You're thinking about it.
Quote something before because
now,
of
hold on, Fala, please wait. Zelda, you said that you have one point to make, and then we'll go to Mike, and then we'll go to Buddha, and then we'll go back to Fala.
Okay. Baby, you kept saying that we keep using the word force, and we're making it sound as if you are the one forcing her to keep the baby to term when you don't believe that abortion is a legitimate option. Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, the thing is, if you are voting for this to ban it, even if you personally do not believe it is a legitimate option, you are forcing her.
Well, no, I'm not.
How do you not understand that you are? If you are trying to make this legislation that abortions cannot be done under any fucking circumstances, then you are, in fact, forcing a woman that has gotten pregnant of her, not of her free fucking will, to carry a pregnancy.
Yeah. I would be forcing her in the same way I would be forcing a sociopath not to commit murder.
It's not a sociopath.
It's a correlation. I'm not calling her a sociopath. I don't think
it's a correlation, but it's a bad correlation. They are not analogous.
I just think that abortion is valid, and I don't. I think it's murder.
You can murder all you like.
All you're murdering is a bundle of cells, or at best a bundle of cells and potential body parts. Brain function doesn't begin until the third trimester.
Well, we cannot justify terminating the unborn based on brain function because there are born babies with poor brain function, and that would then mean that they are lesser human than we think they are.
Yeah.
No, they still have brain function.
Defend IG while he's not here.
Let me ask you a question. Do you eat sunflower seeds?
Yes, but sunflower seeds are not human.
That's the most analogous thing to what happens during an abortion.
Yeah, we're talking about babies with no brain function at all.
They can't even feel pain yet, is the issue here. But for you to say that you're not enforcing, you are.
There's no brain function. Okay, so can I please answer people before another topic gets brought up?
You know what? You can forget my topic, honey. Bye-bye, fuck off.
Well, I want to answer it. If we're going to have an issue sitting race quit, I still want to answer it.
Good.
I don't believe that abortion is a valid... I don't believe that abortion is a valid choice, just like I don't believe that murder is a valid choice. So when a woman commits... if I tell a woman that she's not allowed to commit, if for whatever reason, if for whatever reason we are able to create a society where women are not allowed to have an abortion, I wouldn't be forcing her to do anything because she doesn't have the choice. It's not a valid choice.
Women are still going to go get abortions. If you make it illegal, they're going to go to back alleys with wire coat hangers.
And sociopaths are still going to murder. They're just going to do it undercover.
Not murder.
No difference. Yes,
it's
it
not
is.
Murder. It's the removal of... No.
Yes, it is.
It's the abortion of a potential person. It's not yet
a
person.
It is already a person. It is already
How is it already a person if it's a conceptus or a fetus when it doesn't have brain function?
First of all, personhood does not depend on the functionality of the human body.
It does.
No, it doesn't. If we say that a fetus, just because it doesn't have brain function, is not human, then a baby that is born with a brain function or lesser brain function is lesser than human. That's the only way we can view the mentally handicapped, if we believe that brain function determines how much or how much of...
But there's a difference between poor brain function and absolutely no brain function.
Exactly, and absolutely no brain function would mean that fetus is absolutely not human. And poor brain function...
There's a difference between being human and being... There's a difference between being a person and being human.
And I believe that the fetus is both.
Okay, a corporation legally is human being first...
Of the body.
Okay, there's too much talking over people. All right, we're
hey, guys, I really need to finish on that.
Okay, then. We're going to go into the order. It is Agent of Doubt's turn, and then it is Paula's, and then it is Violent Buddha's, and then it is Complete Rationalities.
Okay, so as far as Brian's argument about the 12-year-old, we're not too removed from the point where we were marrying each other at 12 years old, and it's technology and society that has grown, not our genetics. As far as Evo saying that we can't call people persons without brain function, that's not how I... make my decision on what is a human life or not. I just look at it as whatever has the potential to live a human life. And I think that's the same rule that is used when we say that a double homicide has occurred when a pregnant woman is killed. And we have different legal standards for different things in that respect. Just to link the 180 Hitler eugenics talks to abortion a little bit better, you could make a very good argument about the eugenics ramifications in America when 30% of abortions are from black females and only 10% of the population in America is black, and the places where abortion is the most defended are also the same places where politicians are coming from, where we used to have the largest enclaves of the KKK. So the white abortions that are making up for that actually come from different areas, you know, that are making up the 60-70% if you look at the abortion statistics maps. So there is a eugenics aspect to it, even here in America, that I think is comparable to what went on in Nazi Germany, and it is not just Godwin's law. It is something that you can draw from. And silence.
Okay, can I just close my argument?
All right.
The reality of it is that even society sees it as a necessity. If it were to ease the suffering of any psychological damage, of course, society will allow it. That's the most logical thing to do. Whether you agree with it or not, it doesn't matter. If you want to try to protest that, come up with a more logical reason to do it. But I don't think you're going to find it. There's no way you're going to stop something like this, because it would save someone's life. It would prevent any negative damage towards another life. And that life could also end up becoming psychologically damaged enough to be a dependent on society. So think of what you're doing. If you want to eliminate it altogether, you're going to cause one of two things, either death, or you're going to cause this damage on this person. So there's no way you're going to eliminate that.
What was that, AV?
Well, I know that, and I would just like to say, before we go any further, I would like to reiterate that I understand that I live in a secular society.
Okay, follow, let her speak. Amy, go on and start.
I understand you live in a secular society with people who have different beliefs on abortion, and I understand that you don't like the way that I'm stating my beliefs as if they are facts, but I state them as if they are facts. That's what I believe. They are facts. And my basis for what I believe is based, obviously, in my Christianity and God. And I don't know how to phrase what I'm feeling at the moment, but I respect everything you all are saying. I respect the fact that you all have thought through what you're saying, and you're not just emotionless, like I'm smarter than you all are. But I just have a different basis for what I believe, and I believe that it is the more right basis, and that's how I'm going to present what I believe. And I know that's frustrating a lot of you, but that's the only way I can present it, as if it's the absolute truth. I don't think any of you guys are, like, stupid or just mentally, immorally wrong why you guys are all for, or why those of you who are for abortion. But I can't help but state what I believe the way I do. So just to clear that up.
Although I would never take away someone's choice or their ability to make this moral choice on their own, I would never vote for taking away someone's choice. I personally would make my decisions based on some of the things that are very similar to what AV's saying, in that I don't think there's any amount of human suffering you could stack up against the value of a human life. So personally, I always would side on the side of bringing a life into the world. Because I don't value human suffering as much as I value that human life being born.
Yeah, I value the life or death situation more than I do human suffering also. So,
okay. So did AV say, I missed a bit, just a second. Did AV say that she is in favor of the law banning?
Yes, she is, I believe.
Did I say what?
You would be in favor of the law removing abortion as a choice.
Oh, well, yes, I would be. I mean, okay. I can only live, like I said, I can only live my life in the way that I believe is objectively right. I mean, I'm not going to change my beliefs according to what what people think is emotionally right or right for society. I mean, I can only live in the way that I believe is true. And I respect your right to believe in the, to live the way that you believe. So, I mean, yeah. I mean,
okay.
I just...
Okay,
yeah.
Okay, everybody stop. Okay, Buddha came into the call and he's been waiting now patiently. Buddha, you have something to ask Avery Owens?
Yeah, I just have one really small thing to ask. Something you said a few times that rather irked me was you said that abortion was not a legitimate or a valid choice, and I was just wondering how is that even... How can you make that statement? Because it is an option, so that makes it a valid choice. Like, how is it not? That's something I've been wondering ever since the very first time you said it.
Well, I mean, just because we are our technology is able to present it as a choice for us to have, doesn't mean it's a morally valid choice. That's what I mean. Of course, it's a practical. Of course, it's practically valid, as in that we can do it, but it doesn't, I don't believe that it's morally valid.
Also, she might not be explaining herself so that you can understand her, but for me, the weighing of people's pain and suffering for 9 months in having a child versus the child being dead, to me, the pain and suffering is so small on that scale that it almost does seem to me to be, like, not an option, you know? So I understand it from a hyperbole sense to say that it's not an option, because it just seems like, to me, if I'm in that position, why would I even consider the pain and suffering versus a life? A life is so worth so much more. You know?
Okay. And one of the major differences between you and A.B. Owens is that you are willing to let the mother have the choice if they want to have that child or not, where A.B. Owens is for legislation to remove that choice from women, regardless of the situation. And
mostly that is because I believe that my morality is coming from a subjective viewpoint of myself, and I wouldn't choose for somebody else, but she believes in an objective morality from God.
So I can only live according to what I believe is objectively true. If I allow for legislation for abortion, that would be
there is no legislation for abortion, it's a choice that women have. The legislation that is being put out there is to take that choice away from our women from all circumstances, and that's what we are arguing with, or that's what we are talking about. Hold on a moment. I need to start a new recording. Okay, Brian.
You can make a point if you speak up.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay, how's that?
Brian, hold on a moment, please.
Okay. I'll be right back up.
Okay, recording of part 6 started. Go on, Brian.
Okay, I'd just like to ask A.V., going back to the previous question, how she would feel if her daughter at the age of 9 was raped and conceived and was unable to save her daughter's life as a result of a law being in place that removed the option to do so.
Okay, well, I could answer this two ways.
I want to know what's in your heart, Avery.
Well, okay, I don't believe what's in my what my emotions matter. It's what I believe is objectively true. And I have to live my life according to what I believe is true. And of course, if that ever happens, there will be a part of me that won't care about what I believe is objectively true. Of course, it's the same for everybody. Everybody becomes a hypocrite when things become tough. But what I believe from an objective standpoint is that abortion is always, always, always wrong.
Okay, so from that standpoint, do you think you would find the strength just to let your daughter die?
Okay, but what kind of abortion are we talking about? Because
one that will save her life.
Ava, you have already stated that you think that all abortions, no matter what, is wrong.
No, I said that in the beginning that if it's for the ectopic pregnancy, it would be, in my opinion, considered a medical procedure. It's an impossible pregnancy.
Well, that's fine.
I asked you, do you think that all abortions are wrong, no matter what? And you said yes.
Yes, as in, if it's a possible pregnancy and a woman chooses to terminate the pregnancy, then that is what I consider an abortion, and that's what I consider is wrong. But an impossible, a physically impossible pregnancy would be like an ectopic pregnancy.
Okay, so you are for, because of certain medical reasons, that an abortion is okay.
But I wouldn't call it an abortion to begin with, and I wouldn't just say any medical reason. I would say when the pregnancy is...
I said for some medical reasons. I didn't say for all. I said for some.
When the pregnancy is impossible, when it's an impossible pregnancy, that's the only medical reason.
That's the only medical reason that you can think of to have an abortion.
To have a medical procedure
the trouble with that is that the medical procedure is called an abortion.
If you have a law in place
that outlaws abortion, that procedure becomes illegal.
Yes.
Yeah, we're using denotation.
Well, and just like what I'm trying to do and to specify the terms that I'm using, so should that law.
The law doesn't.
Yes, that law doesn't. The way that certain laws are coming are trying to come out, they're saying that no matter what, you cannot get an abortion. For medical defects that happen during pregnancy, for complications that will kill either the mother, the child, or both, there are certain laws that are trying to be passed that will not allow a woman to have the choice to have an abortion if she needs one or if she wants one.
Yeah, legal-wise, the definition of abortion is pretty clear. I think you're going off connotations of, like, what people think about when they hear abortion, but, yeah.
Well, yeah, that's exactly what I'm doing. Like, I wouldn't ever say that I'm for abortion in any circumstance, but I would specify what I mean by that kind of abortion when I'm speaking it about just because of the connotation of abortion, that abortion holds. But back to, I don't know who was speaking last, but I don't believe that abortion should be done if the mother is going to die or if the child is going to die. I believe it should only be done in impossible pregnancy. So mothers have been dying.
I don't think that an abortion...
Do you think that the mother and the child should die instead of just removing the fetus? There's no brain function until after 25 weeks. For society to casually allow abortion, I disagree with that. And at least they should meet us at the point of putting a limit on that.
Okay, I want to present a scenario to Aiden.
Mothers have been dying for all of human history, and so have babies been dying for all of human history. That's a part of our reality. Don't then resort to evil.
And we have the technology now and the understanding to reduce
it. It doesn't matter if we call it technology. It's still evil. It's still acting in an evil way.
Whoa. It does matter. When you make the
technology's
argument.
Technology's acting in an evil way.
We're using you can use technology, but it's still our acting evil. It doesn't matter.
Is it inherent for preventing any psychological damage
We've already gone through this. Psychological damage happens for all sorts of reasons other than a rape mother having to carry her baby that she does not want. If we then say that a mother can have an abortion solely for the fact of alleviating psychological problems, then that opens the door for anyone who wants to alleviate or solve some sort of psychological problem.
And there are cases where that is valid, where that has been valid thing where a woman will get pregnant, but mentally she cannot psychologically handle carrying a baby inside of her.
Okay, I just have to say something real quick. Not dealing with psychological issues. People throughout history have been getting polio, so now that we have the technology, we shouldn't vaccinate people.
Okay, but if the only way we could vaccinate polio was by doing something evil, then I would say that the vaccination is evil, but vaccination has nothing to do with evil, doing something evil.
But you prevented someone's death. How is that evil?
Thank you. AD, do you understand that concepts of good and evil and right and wrong are human constructs and that they are all subjective to each individual?
That is not her understanding, and she's made it clear.
Because I believe that morals are good and evil are objective. I'm Christian.
Okay.
So I'm going to live my life
according to my
beliefs.
Right.
How
do you know what's objectively right? Yeah.
Well, because God exists, first of all, and He reveals what is.
We're not
going to reveal.
Okay, A.V., you may think that a God exists, and you may think
so
that there
think
is such a thing as objective. Okay, A.V., I'm speaking. Okay? You may think that a God exists. You may think that there is something called objective morality, but neither one of those two things have ever been proven. Scientifically speaking... A.V., I'm still talking. Okay? Scientifically and psychologically speaking, morals have been considered and are still considered subjective to each individual.
That is wonderful. That has nothing to do with what I know to be true, though. And I know that God exists, and because God exists, I know that objective morals exist, and I live my life according to the objective morals, just like you live your life according to your subjective morals. I mean, what's the difference? Why am I not entitled to live according to objective morality?
Okay. Can I ask you a question, please?
Wait, can I get my turn, please?
The problem is that you're willing to take what you think is an objective moral and push that onto other people. By telling another woman that she does not have the right to choose what she does with her own body.
And you're pushing what you admit is only a subjective belief on a woman by telling her it's okay to murder her unborn child.
No one's making it mandatory, Avery.
Yes, nobody's making it mandatory. Nobody. I'm not trying to push something. I am just saying that that woman has the right to choose to do with her body what she wants.
And the only reason why it's not mandatory, Avery. It doesn't matter if it's mandatory or not. It has nothing to do with it.
You're making it sound mandatory.
It doesn't matter if I'm making it sound mandatory. It's the only way that I can voice my belief because I believe that they are objective. If I do not believe that my beliefs are objective, then that would be a totally different thing.
And nobody is saying that you are not free to live your life by your standards and your morality.
Yeah,
it's because you believe that your morality is subjective. I believe that my morality is objective. Therefore,
that
I must
doesn't make
my life.
It so.
It's that exactly. Make it so. Yeah, that's wonderful. I know you believe that that doesn't make it so, but to me it is so. So therefore, when I voice my opinion about abortion, when I go to the ballot box to vote on abortion, I live according to what I believe is so.
And that is your right.
That abortion is objectively wrong.
And that is your right.
I have a question for Avery.
Exactly.
Wait, can I please get my turn?
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, yep. Then hold on. It goes completely headless. Headless actually typed into the chat before Michael spoke. So it will go completely headless and then Michael. So completely.
Okay. First, I just want to say, Avi, I appreciate you being on the call. You're very competitive and you express your opinions. But is the Bible what tells you what is objectively right?
It's the Bible that confirms what I believe is objectively right.
Okay, well, all right, what I want to do is just present you with a scenario here. So say there's a killer in your house, and he's shooting you, like, every 10 seconds, but you have a gun by your side. Now, you can choose to kill him and live, or you can die. So if you did choose to kill him and live, are you wrong, or would you admit that somehow it may be justified that you kill that person to live?
Well, I don't believe that self-defense is wrong. I don't believe killing out of self-defense is wrong.
Okay,
and I don't think that...
I'm not exactly going with self-defense here. I'm going with the idea that you're killing another person in order for you to live, which is synonymous with the idea that we were talking about a baby killing a mother.
Your question asked if a murderer was shooting me every few seconds.
Right. It's a life or death situation. You can kill that person and live, or you cannot kill that person and die. Now, if you have a baby that's killing you, now you can kill that baby and live, or you can both die. That's the principle I'm going on here, but it's two different scenarios, sort of.
Give me a second. The difference would be that the difference is that the baby is not necessarily killing me. It's just that the situation that it's in, that my body cannot properly carry a child. So it would not be a result of the baby maliciously trying to kill me. I understand where you're getting, and I understand that that's where my beliefs get complicated. And that is something that I'm going to have to take a little bit of time on to think about how I would properly justify my beliefs with that situation or change them.
Okay,
so,
I get what you're saying. It's not the baby's fault. But it is the killer's fault.
Yeah. But at the same time, it's another one of those situations where I still need to either revamp my belief or find a way to properly justify that situation within my belief. So I don't know how to answer that question.
Okay, well, that will suffice. I have one more question I just want to, well, something I just want to address. When we talk about babies that don't have a brain, I don't think everyone necessarily says that they're not human. Now, I wouldn't call them a person, but in a sense, they're human. But the thing is, if they have no brain function, then they are not alive. So it makes no sense to say you can take a life when there's nothing alive to begin with. So I don't know if you misunderstood, but I don't know who it was earlier and was trying to explain that to you. But yeah, that's pretty much what the issue is.
But they have a beating heart.
No, look, if you are deprived of oxygen for 8 minutes, your brain, you're going to be dead. But if your heart is still beating, I mean, you're still dead. Like, people can be on life support. The heart pumps blood. You can have a machine pump blood for you, but technically, if your brain is not functioning, you're dead.
So are we comparing the vegetable to the fetus?
Say that again.
Are we comparing the vegetable to the fetus?
Up to a certain
like the vegetable.
Yes.
Can you hear that?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, in the vegetable's case, it's being kept alive. In the fetus's case, it's a necessary stage to be. It's a necessary stage of life. It's a necessary stage of living. So that's where I would state see the difference.
Okay, well,
like,
that makes sense. But the argument itself is that it's even so, it's not alive if there's no brain.
Okay, it's still a necessary stage of living. But and I still, it's still alive. It's still alive.
It's a living organism, but. When we talk about human life, it's contingent upon a brain. There's no way to get around that.
But that's your contingency. It's not mine. I don't.
No, that's pure fact. That's pure fact.
It's not fact. That's not fact. That's a belief. The belief that alive is determined by the brain. That's a belief. It's not fact. That is just a that's a belief that we base on a stage of living. It's not. I don't think that's a fact,
it's
just a belief.
I think what we're actually talking about here is sentience, conscious sentience.
But I don't believe that it's sentience determines personhood or being alive.
Well, okay.
So you would grant the same rights of life to what you call the vegetable?
No, because it is dying. It's dying. It's being kept alive. It's not living, it's not in a necessary stage of living.
There are some cases, in fact plenty of cases, where such air quotes vegetables are self-sustaining.
Well then I wouldn't justify killing them because that's assisted suicide and I don't agree with that.
Okay,
Interesting distinction.
Okay, let's move on because Headless has a question, and then Mike is after Headless.
AV, you stated that when you vote, you would vote against abortion.
Yes. Who's speaking? Just for my information.
I am.
Headless chicken.
I'm the one there with the probably a question mark to you. If you look on Blog TV, I'm the one with the little chicken icon.
Okay.
Have you ever voted against abortion?
No. I've never...
No.
I'm Canadian, right? So we've never had the option to vote yet.
Actually, we did in 1968 to 1969, because this was introduced by Pierre Trudeau.
Yeah, but I am 22.
Yes, so you've never actually been able to vote against it. We've had it for that long, and we've been pro-choice since then. Across the country. Some regions are, some of the rules change a little bit province to province, but we've been pro-choice for that long.
He's
the definition of pro-choice is you have the choice when it's required.
You were cutting out. I didn't hear you.
What part did I cut out on?
Restate what you said.
We've been pro-Canada has pro-choice on abortion since 1969.
Therefore,
and the definition of pro-choice is to be able to choose when it's required and necessary. When you tell someone that they can't have something, what are you doing to them?
What would I be doing to them?
You're taking a freedom away.
Okay. But you have to understand that I understand that
what a lot of this argument comes down to is the ability to choose what a woman does with her body.
Okay, but you have to understand that I understand we're living in a secular society that has their own rules that are different from mine. But just because...
Well, wait a minute. In 1968-1969, when this was changed, once the camp was pretty much living like you, a Christian, okay? Who do you think voted for this?
It doesn't matter. My beliefs are not determined by the majority vote.
Okay. Why are you trying to determine what everybody else gets with your vote? And
because
try to tell
it's my
us,
vote.
And it cannot
vote.
Tell us. You are trying to tell us what we can and cannot have.
My belief is that abortion is not a valid choice. So I wouldn't be taking anything away from women. The only way I could take something away from someone, take their choice away from someone, if I believe it's a valid choice to begin with.
So you do not believe that a woman should have the right to choose to have an abortion?
I don't believe that abortion is a right. So you're just using words that make me sound bad if I enter in the negative.
Okay, you say that you don't want to take anything away from her, right?
I wouldn't be taking anything away from women because I don't believe they have.
In the case of her being pregnant will cause her death, are you or are you not taking her life away? That's taking
her right to life away.
No, I wouldn't be.
yes, you are actually.
I wouldn't be.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes,
you would be in the case of a 12-year-old girl. You wouldn't be in the case of an ectopic pregnancy.
It's not okay, but I'm not the one who got her pregnant.
You're the one taking the choice away.
I don't believe it's a valid choice. I wouldn't be taking anything away from her.
You are taking away the right for her to choose whether it's a valid choice for her or not.
But I don't believe that is a right she should have.
What if she does? What if she does?
Well, then, if she does, there are a lot of people who believe that they should be able to do things that they shouldn't. Does that mean that because I am therefore enforcing them with the law that they can't do that, then I'm... taking away a right to do something?
It depends. Well, it depends whether what they are choosing to do is rational and justifiable.
Everything is justifiable. Under secular morality, under atheism, everything is justifiable.
You're
generalizing and straw man.
Yes.
I'm not generalizing anything.
You are. Sorry.
Would you at least vote for a limit? I mean, would you take that step to at least vote for a limit? I mean,
I would not. I think you're having an issue with understanding that I believe that my beliefs are objective and I live according to my objective beliefs. So it doesn't matter.
I think, to be fair, AV needs to think about what she would do with regards some of the situations she has encountered during this conversation before she actually is pushed into any particular corner. Again.
AV, this entire video, this entire 3 hours that we've been live, this will be on my channel, and you can revisit anything that anyone says and make a video about it. It'll be Creative Commons for anyone to grab.
Absolutely.
Same thing goes for anyone in here. Anyone who wants to rebut to anyone that you didn't get a chance.
I think someone's just exercised their right to fall downstairs.
Okay. Michael, you have something you want to...
Yeah, I do. Avi,
yeah.
Is it your understanding of the Bible that when a whole bunch of people start doing bad things in a nation, that God starts to not favor that nation anymore?
I don't believe that God has ever favored a nation. After Israel, he's never favored a nation.
But what I'm saying is, do you believe that if a whole bunch of people start sinning and sinning and sinning in worse and worse ways, that worse things will happen to them because God won't favor them as much? Like Sodom and Gomorrah, or...
That's such a loaded question, because I don't believe, after Christ, I don't believe that God will ever react to humanity the way he did in the Old Testament.
Okay.
And also the Bible says that...
He told us he's coming back. What are you talking about? He's like, reacting. He reacts through us through the scriptures.
Who's the one speaking right now?
That was Stigma Dane.
Okay, he's not going... He doesn't react to a specific nation in the same way that
he... first know about him? You read about him, right? You heard about him. You were influenced by him. That's
okay.
How you connected with him.
Okay. So God is never going to react to a nation in the way that Ancient of Doubt previously stated, in the same way that he's going to, that he did in the Old Testament. I believe those days are over. And the Bible states that the world getting more strength is going to continue to get more strength.
Does your Bible contain a book of Revelations or not? What
the... The Book of Revelation happens at the end of human history. It doesn't happen throughout human history. Right? So,
there's a series of events that are expected among Christian people to happen. And these are political events as well. Disaster events.
So, what I'm getting at here is, you don't believe that if abortions increase in a nation, that God's favor will be retracted? Because to me, that seems like a Christian reason to vote against abortion, is you might think that God will start punishing your country.
No, I believe that abortion increasing in a nation is a reflection of God's judgment on the nation. It's not independent of God's nation, of God's judgment. And that's not how I view,
So it's part of the punishment, actually.
I don't believe that the choices of the nation...
Agent of Doubt, if I may?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Have you ever seen a Canadian winter? God can't punish Canada anymore.
I've seen a Wisconsin winter, but never a Canadian winter.
It's kind of like that.
Well, I understand that you have it a little bit worse than that.
There's nothing God could throw.
Jacksonville, Florida, the worst punishment ever.
Okay, let's kind of move this one point back. Avi, to help reduce the number of abortions that go on just in this country alone. Actually, the recording ran out. Hold on, I have to reset it.
Oh yeah.
Dar, you ruined the flow.
I know I ruined the flow. It's not my fault.
What are you talking about? You're the one who has control of the record button.
Yo, it's a 30-minute thing. You leave me alone, man. Don't make me make you more of my...
Who are you going to blame, God?
Look, Michael, it's not Dar's fault. He left it running. He got up to go get some purple drink. He came back and the 30 minutes ran out.
I don't drink purple drink. I drink coffee.
What is it? What it is he had to give a periodical report to the gay agenda.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Okay.
He must be informed of the gay agenda.
Yeah.
Don't worry. The addendum is coming. AB Owens.
Yep.
To reduce the number of pregnancies that happen in the United States, regardless if you agree with abortions or not, do you think that sex education should be reintroduced into the school systems?
That's a loaded question. I don't believe that public school helps society in any way. I don't believe public education helps society at all. I'm not a libertarian, but I sympathize with libertarian beliefs. And I don't believe that sex education has done anything to help the teen sex or STD epidemic at all. So reintroducing sex education would be kind of pointless.
Okay, Avi, I'm 10 years older than you, okay? So
that's one of
the Avi, let me make my point, please, okay? I'm 10 years older than you. When I was in junior high and beginning high school, we had sex education, okay? This would be the real late 80s into the early 90s that I am talking about. And my generation was the last generation that had any kind of comprehensive sex education, where we were taught about the human body and how it develops. We were taught about condoms. We were taught about contraceptives. We were taught about pregnancy. We had all of that. That time period of the mid-80s to the early 90s was the lowest teen pregnancy rate and lowest rates of STDs among teens that we have ever had in this country.
Dark, what was the first time that you had heard that in the public school system? Was it in high school, or was there any other...
It was when I was in sixth grade.
Wow, they presented to us that in fifth grade.
Fifth grade for me.
What country are you talking about? Where did you get those?
This is the United States.
This is the United States.
Well, I'm in Canada, right?
You're in Canada?
Yeah.
Lovely state of Canada.
Okay.
Do you have sex education here in Canada, and teen pregnancy is still on the rise in Canada?
Okay, well, I don't know what kind of classes. What do they cover in those classes?
They cover everything. There isn't anything I've learned from my mother or society that I did not learn in sex education in my school.
Okay, then did they cover safe sex? Did they cover how to use a condom?
They covered everything. Condoms with bananas, everything.
Okay, and what is the teen pregnancy rate right now?
Well, I'll have to look that up.
Okay, because I will tell you this, from my own observations from here in the United States, when those programs were pulled out of schools, teen pregnancies and transmissions of STDs skyrocketed, because children were not taught anymore. They were not taught about their bodies. They were not taught about safe sex. They were not taught about condom use. They were not taught about STDs and how they spread.
But why isn't that the duty of the parents? Why do we load that on?
I will admit that.
How can the parents teach their children something when the parents may not know what it is either?
Parents don't know what sex is.
About contraceptives and STDs, when those parents weren't taught that either.
Okay, Well, that's why in the beginning I said it was a loaded
question. That's why we go to school, to learn things.
It's not a loaded question at all.
Well, yes, it is, because my belief on about sex are for... Answer what question?
It's a loaded question, please.
Because my beliefs about sex are very different from your beliefs.
I don't care about your beliefs about sex. I'm asking you, why do you think it is a loaded question?
Because my beliefs about sex are different from your beliefs about sex.
Don't care about
Dar!
The definition of a loaded question is a question that's designed for you to incriminate yourself. Does anyone agree?
Yeah,
I would agree.
Yeah.
Okay, so what
I'm
about...
I'm not going to answer that question because it's loaded.
What about that question is going to make you incriminate yourself, or...
Because your question asks me if I believe that sex education entering into the schools will help the abortion rates go down. And I don't believe that abortion rates have anything to do with sex education or the lack of sex education.
Oh my God, how can you sit there and say that?
Dar, let her finish, man.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Like, I'm guessing like most other Christians, my beliefs about sex education is that it's abstinence. It has nothing to do with whether or not a child knows how to put on its condom. I mean, I believe that children should know how to, but I think the main problem with sex education is that it encourages children to have sex before they're even ready. And just because they have a condom, it's okay. I believe that if people respected sex in the same way that I as a Christian do, then the abortion rates would go down.
I think part of this argument is that nobody is suggesting that sex be mandatory.
I am.
Well, yeah, you can, Mike, at your age.
Human nature doesn't need for us to make anything mandatory. You give us an inch and we'll take a mile. That's how human nature works. Once we say that we're allowed to...
With that example that you just put out there, that's what's going to happen, all right? It's been shown from generation to generation that when kids hit preteen and teen, that their bodies change and that they are going to experiment.
Oh my goodness, I did not know that at all. But the fact is that our society does not teach these children how to, from my perspective, our society does not teach our children how to respect the changes in their body and how to respect sex.
And with sexual education, you can teach children to respect that change and teach them to understand the changes that are happening to them so that they can respect it. And when they have a frame of reference for when they will engage in sexual activities, that it will give them something to think on.
What do you mean by respect their change?
Well, just because they have wet dreams, it doesn't mean that they're capable of having sex. That's what I mean, respect their changes.
Do you mean just respect themselves or something like that?
Well, just understand. No, well, okay, maybe respect their changes is a bad use of words. I just mean that sex education I don't want to say prevent, but it sort of encourages. It says that since you are changing, now you can have sex, and here's a condom, go do it. That's what I believe sex education does.
No, it doesn't. None of the sex educations ever did that. None of them said, okay, here, go and have sex. No.
But that's not what I said.
Is teaching the children about their own bodies, about the changes that are going on, and teaching them that if, in capital letters, if they choose when to have sex, that it is more preferable to be protected, so that you do not get any unwanted pregnancies and do not get any STDs.
That's wonderful, but if that's just, say, The first are not even listening to me. If our society does not reflect the moral values, our society doesn't reflect the moral values that I hold about sex. And I think that that's the problem. That's the reason why teen pregnancies are on the rise and why abortions are on the rise. I don't believe it has anything to do with sex education. Because teaching people how to put on a condom, it doesn't mean that they're going to always use it. AIDS and STDs are still on the rise, even though everyone has access to a condom.
Okay, and what about the drop? What about the drop of STDs, infection rates, and teen pregnancy rates that happened in the mid 80s to early 90s when these programs were around?
As devil's advocate, I'd just like to say that it could be a lot of people got scared of AIDS.
That could be it, and people had a different perspective on sex than we do in this present time.
And one of the reasons for that is because we are not teaching our children about their own bodies. And
teaching children about their bodies is meaningless if we don't also give them some moral guidelines as to how they're supposed to use their bodies. That is where I'm coming from.
Okay, I have a question. Where does morality factor in when it comes to something like sex?
Well, do you not know what the Christians believe about sex?
You are never going to walk my dog, ever.
Brian is up next after you.
I'm not talking about, with a 20-year-old having sex with an 8-year-old. I'm just talking about specifically when it's an appropriate, action. Like, what's morally wrong about, an 18-year-old girl having sex with an 18-year-old guy?
Well, from a secular perspective, obviously there's definitely...
No.
But from a Christian perspective?
No, we're not saying secular or Christian, but we're asking you for your own personal opinion.
Well, I've already reiterated 100 times that I make it a duty of mine to line up my morality to that of the Bible. So, obviously, my morality on sex is that people shouldn't have it until they're married.
Okay then, and that's fine for you to have your own point of view on that.
Okay, wait. No, even so, what does that have to do with sex education and teaching about STDs and all these other things?
Maybe I just didn't make it clear. All of that information is useless if we don't then impart some sort of morality onto our children about sex. It doesn't matter if they know how babies are made. The whole point, the factors is that they're still having sex and they're still doing it carelessly and they're still doing it dangerously.
Because
we don't have any moral guidelines. We just sort of tell them, here's a condom.
Here's a moral guideline you gave me. You said that they shouldn't do it until they're married. So, how does that factor into STDs and sex education? How is that a guideline with this particular issue?
With STDs?
Yeah, and in a sense that matters, but. Basically, sex education overall. Like, how is that a moral guideline for this?
It's a moral guideline for children.
We're talking about eight people who are grown.
So, you think we should raise our children to just let a parent die because of any problems with the pregnancy?
Okay, we already went over that.
Brian, I'm wondering what kind of church she goes to.
Okay, Brian has a point, or has a question. Brian?
Okay, I would hazard to put into the conversation at this point that sex education in schools is all about the delivery of facts. Morality, that... rightfully is within the purview of the parent. And sex ed in school at no way professes to teach anything other than fact.
It does not presuppose to impose a morality.
So is that an objection to what I said, or?
That is just a statement of fact.
Oh, yes, it is. Yeah, and I wholly agree, but if our society doesn't reflect any moral guidelines, then such education is pointless. If our society glorifies sex, inhibited sex, careless sex, then what's the point of teaching our children about condoms?
All I can do is put to you the proposition that when it comes to society morals, then that is down to parental control. What you seem to be advocating is a state morality that is imposed over absolutely everybody and anybody, regardless of their own secular morality.
No, I'm not, because I'm sorry, I don't even know who asked me the question, but the first question I know Brian is the one who's talking to me right now, but I don't know who the first person started on.
I was making an observation and asking you a question on the basis of your response.
But maybe I misunderstood the question, because I was not advocating that sex education should teach children morality. As I said earlier, sex education should be the responsibility of the parents, and it was better when it was the responsibility of the parents. But what I'm saying is that I don't believe that sex education matters if our society, if our parents do not impart some sort of moral guideline when it comes to sex.
So moral guidelines are required in order to understand STDs and...
No!
That is exactly what you just said.
No, I said there is... It's irrelevant. Just let me respond to this. Who cares if we know what a condom is? Who cares if we know what STDs are? And who cares if we know how to prevent them? If our society still glorifies irresponsible sex, what's the point in knowing how to prevent STDs if our society still glorifies the kind of sex that will allow for our children
I can appreciate that as a valid concern. And as far as that is concerned, you would have to take issue with various advertising agencies and media policies. Not attack the education system. It's not a morality that is being taught as part of the education system. Morality, as we've agreed, comes from parental involvement in sex education.
If
society's morals are wrong, then there's something in the overall morality of the parents or what the parents is imparting, surely. What's being taught factually in the education system.
But somebody had asked me whether or not I think including sex education into the education system would help the abortion issue, and I said no, because our society does not.
What I'm pointing out to you is that your argument is based on the morality, which is not actually an issue in the education and the education of sex issues within the education system.
The argument of
morality is not an argument against sex education, because morality isn't the purview of sex education.
But I wasn't arguing that. I was just saying that sex education is...
What I'm pointing out is that your argument against sex education is on the moral basis.
Okay.
Which is irrelevant to that argument.
Is law.
Okay.
You said that sex education is pointless if you don't have any morals, right?
Yeah.
Okay, that comes with parental influence.
Okay, so what morals... specifically, just name a few, are needed in order for sex education to be meaningful.
Well, do you understand the answers I give will be Christian, will be biblical?
Sure. Throw them at me. I've already responded to the first you gave. I don't remember what it was.
Well, the only moral guideline that I believe is relevant to sex is not to have it until you're married.
So that's the only moral guideline. So if people understand that, that's the only thing they need to understand about morals, then sex education is meaningful.
No, sex education would still be meaningful because we still need to know how sex works. But it's meaningless in the attempt to prevent paralytic pregnancy.
Okay, so it's just that...
Wait a minute.
What?
If you prevent a careless pregnancy by education, then you don't need an abortion.
Are you...
Oh my god.
To what I just said.
Oh my god, I can't believe you just said that. The idea behind sex education is to prevent an unwanted pregnancy.
It's practical. It's about how to practically prevent
that's where pregnancy happens. It happens in the practical world, not in the moral you should not world.
If I tell someone that they should wear a condom when they're having sex, and they don't morally believe that they should have wear a condom, they don't have any moral responsibility in using a condom, then what difference does it make?
Advising somebody to use a condom is giving no moral advice at all. It's just saying, if you're gonna have sex, at least wrap it up.
And
Pope John Paul II said that.
But I agree with that.
Okay, well that's all that sex education is proposing. If you're gonna do it, then at least wrap it up.
But if our society doesn't, what if our society doesn't value
then you take it up with the media and the advertising and everybody that uses sex to sell people things.
Yes.
But then.
Yes.
Okay. But they both need to work together, and I believe that they both need to work together in reducing perilous pregnancies. It cannot.
Okay.
And that is, as Stig and everybody else has been saying, the aim of sex education.
Yes.
To prevent unwanted pregnancies. Therefore, we don't need to have unwanted abortions. Because nobody in this argument is approving of abortion as a means of birth control. Nobody.
Amy, you go to church, correct?
Yes.
At any time at your visit at your church, did the pastor or any member of the congregation show you any sort of diagram of partial birth abortion?
No, I'm capable of... No.
Has it ever been indoctrinated to you as being immoral for any secular means of Christianity?
No.
So you've never seen a diagram of partial birth abortion?
No.
Would you accept a ballot vote for a politician if at least they wanted to vote to try to pass a bill that at least had a limit on abortion? Like 25 weeks?
Why would I do that, though? Like,
to enable the saving of women's lives?
That, it's like everything I said in the last how many hours has gone through one ear and out the other.
No, yeah, it hasn't. This is precisely why we keep asking the same question.
But I'm not ignorant to the fact that women die as a result of being pregnant. I just don't believe.
But because it's happened throughout history, it's okay.
No, I never said it was okay because it's not a moral issue. It's just something that happened.
It's just shit that happens. I'm sorry if I'm being asked, but...
If And
well,
rather,
people have murdered each other throughout history. Is that also shit that happens, or is that something we try and prevent?
No, because murder is a moral issue. Women dying from pregnancy is just something that happens.
Women dying needlessly is something that's preventable.
It's not preventable. It's preventable insofar as we commit another evil to prevent it, and that's where I have the problem.
Can you not see that a life-saving procedure can be viewed as self-defense?
No, because the fetus
if you
is
do nothing,
not
that woman's
intended.
Going to die. If you do nothing, that woman's going to die.
That woman is not the fetus. Does not intend to hurt
Neither does the sociopath that's going out on a, kill prostitute vendetta on behalf of God.
The sociopath has a chemical imbalance.
Yeah.
Well, what? They're still capable of understanding that murder is wrong. Their chemical imbalance, but they have actually
got to the stage where they believe what they are doing is not only right, but commanded of them.
That's a totally different situation because it doesn't matter what we believe, it's what is objectively right or wrong.
Avery, you just said it does not matter what we believe.
It's what is objectively right or wrong.
And what if what you consider objectively right or wrong is the result of a belief?
But if it's a result of a belief, then it's just a belief. But the objective morals that I hold to are not a result of a belief.
Do you believe that they are objective?
I didn't get that. Do I believe they are what?
I know they are objective.
Would you right now say that it's not right to say that you believe in God? It's more right to say that you know there is a God?
No part of this. Exactly.
That's another topic.
Well, that's what she's saying. She's saying that she knows this objective morality. It's not a belief.
Self-sustaining, self-efficient, omnipresent, omnibenevolent. I don't know what it is. The Bible says that
the Holy Spirit is. All Christians share the same point of view on that. In some way, shape, or form. The Holy Spirit is benevolent of God, which we believe to be a supreme consciousness of existence itself.
Jesus is not
the personality of it through inheritance of
sin, and so I don't know what is. Would you be the personality of what?
God.
No, he is a person of God.
Consciousness of existence.
He's a person of God. There are three persons, not three personalities. There are three distinct persons.
I just gave you three distinctions. God being a supreme consciousness, the Holy Spirit being a benevolent influence from that supreme consciousness, and Jesus being a personality of that consciousness.
Well, that's the incorrect description of the
Trinity. That's exactly what it is.
There's no way
to logically, reasonably identify it.
If you identify it any other way,
you're straw manning it.
Okay, the Trinity is two distinct persons. The Holy Spirit is a distinct person.
The Holy Spirit is being defined.
And God is being influential. I don't understand what the whole point of this is.
Spirit is to have influence.
It doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter what
you're
eating.
Put the two words, two definitions of both words together, okay? What do you have? You have this divine benevolent influence.
That may be the person, that may be that person's purpose, but it's not, that's not the nature of that person.
You have no belief that Jesus had any sort of personality that was similar to God's?
No, I already stated what I believe in the Trinity is. They're three persons, they are the same.
Is Jesus God's son or not? Of course he would have hereditary traits.
What are you talking about?
Even said,
okay, Dick, I gotta ask you too. What are you talking about?
Yeah, that made absolutely no sense.
I think what we're trying to ascertain is whether or not Jesus was or was not.
Just trying to figure out the church is, because it's starting to sound like
Or if Jesus was God made flesh.
Yeah, genetics doesn't even factor in when it comes to Jesus and God, so.
Yes, it does. His rationality and logic of life was
Okay, that's not genetics. Genetics is like physical.
That's what he inherited from his father.
Okay, guys, we're way off topic. And we've been going at it for quite some time now.
I'm just trying to find an answer.
And this conversation that is going on is a completely different topic.
Abortion.
This is a completely different topic for a different day.
For another day. Yeah, I've got one thing I want to throw to AD real fast.
Okay.
Okay, so...
Brolat, would be any less confrontational?
Alright, when it comes to abortion, the thing is, you're against it because you're committing an evil by killing the child. Okay, so I'm just wondering if you are willing to admit that there might be some justification behind that evil. For instance, when I gave you the life or death situation, even though it may be evil in some sense, do you not think that there is some justification out there for it?
None that can come to my mind. If there are, then society has yet to see it.
Okay. That's about all I have to say.
Okay, we're actually gonna wrap it up now. For everybody in the chat room, I know that I said that we were gonna talk about Ray Comfort's 180. But we're going to move that to next week, and it will be the first topic that we will talk about. Prince Noob, you will be in that call. I am sorry. I am so sorry, dude. Okay. This will also give everybody else who has not seen the 180 movie to watch it. The link.
Yeah,
is,
phone up.
Yeah, the link is above the chat, and we can talk about it then. A.B. Owens, you're more than welcome to come back for next week's show. I would like to ask everybody that is in the call right now, or was in the call, to link your channel into the blog TV.
And
I'm
on it again.
I'd just like to say, personally, thank you very much to AV. It's been interesting to talk to you. And I look forward to talking
Sorry.
To you.
It's fun listening to you.
Right. Yeah, I wish you could come to every session.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe. Who knows?
I mean, it seemed to me like everyone had a bone to pick with you. Right? I thought you would have liked...
That's how it usually is.
I thought you
They're interesting up. Topics.
Yeah, I'm surprised that you...
Okay, I saw that two people did not have ops that should have
them. I'm surprised you were able to stay on this long and continue to confront the wave of disagreement that came at you.
Hey, you guys, what's the funniest thing to say to Jehovah's Witness?
What's that?
Say this. If you only think that 144,000 people make it into heaven, why are you bothering me if there's no more room? Good point.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Okay, Stigma, if you can repost your channel because you did not have ops when you posted it. Oh, Brian, you don't have ops. I would like to thank everybody for coming to the Friday Night Roundtable that is in the Log TV. I hope y'all all enjoyed it, and we will be back next week. Does anybody want to say goodbye to the room?
Yeah, goodbye. Thanks, Avi, for talking with us. You're very sexy. And LaSoya was a twat for not showing up.
Yeah, that would have been awesome if LaSoya already showed up. How did he miss this?
Okay.
Yeah. Well, his loss. But yeah, bye room and everybody else. Come on, what you got?
All right. Bye, everybody.
Later.